Good afternoon. Welcome to the final day of the Clarkson Cup, the sixth annual one. I'm Sarah Wright for the Streaming Sports Network. Now, today we will find out who the champions are of the Canadian Women's Hockey League. The two teams are Boston Blades and the home team, Toronto Furies. Now, Boston Blades are undefeated going into this game, 3-0 in the tournament, while the Furies, 2-1, their lone loss coming to these Blades, 2-1 on Thursday. Boston does boast the top three scorers of the tournament in Kate Buser, who always seems to show up for the Clarkson Cup, and two Team USA members in Hillary Knight and Kelly Stack. However, they go up against a hot goalie who has been busy this tournament. She is only allowed, Christina Kessler's only allowed 5 goals on a tournament leading 87 shots. She's going to be tough to beat, but these girls are all good, and you never know what's going to happen here at the Clarkson Cup. That's what all the athletes have been saying. It's a brand new day. Forget about the rest of the season. Forget about Wednesday through Friday. It's the final game, and they're all coming out. Now, back to the regular season. It was 4-2 for the Boston Blades. A little bit in favor for the Blades today. However, Toronto does have the home ice advantage, and the fans are rowdy here. They definitely have the Furies on their minds. And I've also heard from some of the Calgary girls that they're definitely cheering for the Furies. Now, gentlemen, I'm going to send it up to you. Let's talk some more, and I'll see you all at intermission.
Thank you very much, Sarah, and welcome everybody to the championship game. I'm here with my good friend Anthony Regan. My name is Asher Roth, and you really couldn't ask for a better matchup. Toronto-Boston, no matter what the sport, no matter what the gender playing it, it's always a huge, exciting matchup.
It's certainly going to be that we have a packed house here, Asher Roth, and I myself didn't sleep well heading into this game. I had a bit of nerves going through my system, and then we talked to Coach Summer West, the head coach of the Furies, and the first question out of our mouths was, how'd you sleep last night? Her answer, well, that's all I'm going into this one. And we spoke also to Digit Murphy, of course, the head coach of the Boston Blades, and she knows that Toronto is a powerful team, and both coaches and both teams know they have to keep their noses clean, i.e. stay out of the penalty box. 4 penalties in a row in the first game in the round robin between these two clubs led to some penalty trouble for the Furies as 2 power play goals cost them. It was Buser with the game-winning goal. There was 5 penalties called against the Blades in a row afterwards. So pretty even that way, but the only problem was Toronto didn't capitalize on their power play opportunities.
Now, speaking of game-winning goals relating to the Boston Blades and specifically relating to Kate Buser, what a tournament she's had. 3 goals in the tournament. I believe she's also got 3 assists. All 3 of her goals have been game-winning goals for Boston. Just an unbelievable tournament for her. And we'll look at also her line mates, Anthony. Yeah. Hillary Knight yesterday, 4 goals, 1 assist. And their line mate as well, Kelly Stack, 1 goal, 4 assists. Buser added 4 points of her own. They are the top 3 leading scorers in the tournament thus far. And I think Toronto will know who they're going to have to cover, or which line specifically.
Yes, indeed. As you said, 4 goals for Knight versus Calgary last night. And an assist, Kelly Stack had a 5-point night. As you said, Buser is just on fire. That lineup is going to be a handful. When you talk, though, to the coaching staff, Digit Murphy, she knew, though, that they would have a bit of an easier time, with all due respect to the Calgary Inferno, because of the defenders and the way they matched up on the ice. They had a bit of an easier time last night, although they're starting to run into a bit of penalty trouble in the second period there. They were settled down when Digit Murphy went in and told her team something to calm them all down. What did she tell them?
Yep, she told us before the game that after 40 minutes, and you noticed probably as well, Anthony, that things were getting a little chippy. They were starting to lay out a couple big hits. Yes. There was some pushing and shoving going on in that second period, and Coach Murphy told her troops, you guys remember, Calgary is playing their final period of the tournament. We've got 4 more, and if you go out there, make the crowd happy, they will cheer for you. And that's essentially what they're playing for today. Now let's quickly segue over to the Toronto Furies, what they had to do to get here. What a game they played yesterday morning against the top team in the regular season, the Montreal Stars.
Boy, this round robin here at the 2014 Clarkson Cup has seen a little bit of everything. We had a referee cut for stitches, stopped the game. We had power outage in our first game here. And it was absolutely incredible what we had. But yesterday, it took the shootout to solve the difference between the Furies and the Stars. Montreal succumbing, and the only one to score for Toronto, no surprise, I suppose, Natalie Spooner on the shootout, getting the job done.
Natalie Spooner with a great tournament. Sorry to cut you off there. Two goals, two assists in the three games for 4 points. The shootout winner on a great dangle move that was able to beat Catherine Heron in such a close game. All sorts of opportunities in the overtime. A great game for Christina Kessler, stopping 34 against the Stars yesterday.
I had a great surprise when I got here. I found my way into the parking lot, and I managed to find myself a spot. And then I walked in, and right then, they were unloading the Clarkson Cup and bringing it inside. I said, is that the cup there inside that container? And they said, yes, yes, it is. So I walked all the way into the arena, felt quite honored. And the neat thing was, people were posing for pictures and buying merchandise. I bought myself a T-shirt and a hat myself to support the CWHL. And I thought, nobody knows that the cup's coming right through them. I wanted to tell everybody, but no, you don't tell the secrets.
No, absolutely not. And it certainly does give it that sort of larger-than-life appeal. And really makes it that much more interesting for
Canadian
the fans if they haven't seen
the
it before, if it is
Sochi
somewhat of a surprise. We're going to turn right now to center ice and PA announcer Eric Therrien as Calgary Inferno player and Canadian gold medalist Tara Watchorn comes to center ice, along with, and I can see in the distance, former Governor General and the founder of the Clarkson Cup, Adrian Clarkson, coming out right now.
Now, with the team captains, please meet at center ice for the official opening face-off. J'invite maintenant les capitaines des deux équipes au centre de la patinoire pour la mise au jeu officielle.
It's such a cool moment there. Jess Koizumi, the captain for the Blades. Brittany Smith, the captain for the Furies, shaking hands with the former Governor General and a broadcasting legend in her own right as well, the Honorable Adrian Clarkson. Along with the Commissioner as well.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you please
Brenda
stand and remove your hats for the singing of the
National
Anthem.
We're going to stop now for the anthems. We'll
be
right back.
To sing the National Anthems, a proud Markhamite who has been singing and acting on stage and screen for over 15 years across Canada and the U.S., Madame Susanna Kiernan.
Broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. O'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket, the bombs bursting, the bombs bursting. Still there. Oh, say, does that star-spangled banner yet wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the des plus brillants exploits.
always an awesome, awesome situation when you hear a whole crowd singing along to the national anthem of our great country of Canada. And speaking of which, I'm going to turn to an old cliche to start this one off. Hello, Canada, and viewers all across the United States and worldwide, streaming live on the CWHL website and the streaming sports network, SSN Canada. This is the 2014 Clarkson Cup Championship game presented by Scotiabank. My name is Asher Roth alongside Anthony Regan. Let's talk about the goaltenders. Wow. We found out a bit of a surprise prior to the game.
Well, there it is right there. Look at the pregame ritual between Lacasse and Ott. Ott got the start. We talked to Digit Murphy about that. She said, boy, you got to go to your goaltenders and tell one of these two outstanding netminders you're going into the net. And then she said, but then again, if Ott doesn't have her usual outstanding performance, I can always put in Lacasse. And I said, that must be a nice position to be in, coach. And she said, it is. She knows the crowd are mostly here from the Toronto area, so they're going to be having their vocal support behind the Furies. However, she was signing autographs and said a family made their way from Providence here as well. And she said, and I have one good fan in the stands here behind us. This is an exciting, I'm getting the goosebumps.
No, absolutely. The anticipation is just really too much. This is really the first time that we've seen a packed house not filled with young children from the local schools around the Markham area. So Brittany Ott, the starting netminder for the Boston Blades, the St. Clair Shores, Michigan native, had herself a pretty great rookie season in the CWHL. 10-6 with a shutout, a 2.63 goals against, and a sparkling 9.21 save percentage. And like you said, Anthony, that's one heck of a luxury to have an Olympian as a backup netminder for a championship game.
A gold medal Olympian, a gold medal winning Olympian. Ott with the main gear on, and that's why she has the blue mask and the gloves and the pads as well. And at the other end of the ice, no slouch yourself, Christina Kessler, my friend.
Kessler had herself a heck of a game against Montreal as we're underway. Natalie Spooner wins the opening faceoff, and here we go. The Clarkson Cup Championship presented by Scotiabank on SSN Canada. Kate Buser wearing number 20 for the Boston Blades dumps it into the corner handled by Benome. She passes it up to Janelle Kohanchuk, who had one heck of a move yesterday coming off a game on Thursday in which it looked like she might have gotten hurt. Buser handles it behind the Toronto net, being chased by two defenders, Spooner and Smith. And now Benome helps out and passes up to Megan Arts, who had a breakaway chance herself yesterday. Now Kohanchuk goes in with speed along the left wing, being watched closely by Bolden, who is so solid on defense for the Blades. And Digit Murphy was saying before the game, has a rocket of a shot. One of the few players, she said, she's ever seen in the women's game that breaks so many sticks in practice.
She said even more sticks than Knighter, as she calls Hillary Knight.
Of course, Knight is no slouch herself. Four goals in yesterday's game, 5 points overall. In on five of the six of those points as the Blades go offside. Ahead of the play a little bit there was Kelly Cook.
Stephanie Gagnon and Brandy Duar are the two referees, and the lines persons are Lizanne Patry and Vanessa Stratton as well.
So we're just over a minute into this opening period. Hoffmeyer passes up to Holly Carey Matamo, who scored the lone goal in the game between these two teams in the round robin. It was a beauty coming from behind the net and lifting a beautiful backhand shot off of the mask of Genevieve Lacasse, as it looked like that one was touched by one of the Blades players on the bench.
That was the third goal of that game. It was day two in the morning game here against Boston and Toronto. Two goals for Boston, both of them coming on the power play. Knight scoring, I believe it was a 5-on-3 to start. And then Buser got the game-winning goal, as you said. And then Holly Carey Matamo with a doozy as well. All those goals coming in the first period. So these teams are pretty much even. A one-goal game in that one.
On the attack now, Boston. Bolden gets laid out there by Beezer, who there were some questions of whether or not she was going to play. The puck was loose as Kessler did not have a handle on it. And the ref whistled it down maybe a little prematurely.
Yeah, and don't forget, you know, the eyes of the hockey world are upon this ice surface here in Markham, Ontario. It's a lot of pressure on the players. The fans can sit back and relax, but the officials on the ice, they're under the microscope as well. They're doing a terrific job.
And a reminder to fans at home, as you have all throughout the tournament, Anthony's Twitter handle in a moment. It's a little Anthony's Twitter handle in a moment. It's a little Anthony's Twitter handle in a moment. It's a little hard to remember.
I think I've sent 3 tweets in my entire life, my friend. I'm getting there, though.
Hey, at this rate, you'll have about 10 times as many followers just by the end of this game as Smith gives a shove to Hillary Knight. So dangerous, wearing number 27 for the Boston Blades. There's Bolden. She gets shoved there by Arts. Still working behind the Blades net, trying to pressure them into making a mistake. Knocked up the boards by Casey Bellamy, and now handled by the Furies. There's Spooner with a shot in the slot, turned aside by the blocker of Brittany Ott, who had a shutout, the only shutout in this tournament on day one against those dangerous Montreal Stars.
Bellamy took a look there. She was sort of in that nether region between the net where she should be sort of like protecting, and Spooner, who had the puck there, she sort of started out towards her and thought, I better back off and be responsible defensively.
And a chance there. Vela centered it. Ott will cover it up on a scoring chance in front by, I believe, Christy Zamora. And listen to that crowd giving a little bit of appreciation to the Furies for that scoring chance.
It looked like the centering pass was knocked out of midair by the stick of Ott. Watch this as we take a look here at the replay. They gained the zone. Pretty good job there. But it was shaping up pretty interestingly for Toronto, as you have to hurry back to help out. Here comes the centering pass. There it is. The paddle came out and denied a great scoring opportunity.
They battle in the corner. There's Jill Dempsey.
She doesn't know the word quit when it comes to competing.
No, she really doesn't. She's been so aggressive in this tournament, a huge part of why the Blades have only allowed 3 goals in their 3 round-robin games in the tournament. Koizumi there to help out as Prevost for Toronto, number 27, lost it along the boards. Now rushing in Koizumi against Kessler in a foot race, and Kessler makes the pass to Bonello. Up is Corey Chevry, holds onto it. Some nice defense there by Bolden. He's gotten lots of playing time so far in this one.
And deservedly so, would you say, Asher? After you've seen her play a few games here, she's another one of those tremendous athletes who doesn't know the meaning of the word quit. She's got an NHL-caliber slap shot, and she can lug the puck out of her zone. Great foot speed, great vision of the ice, tremendous puck distribution.
And a real standout as well in this tournament. And hard to believe that she's only a rookie as well, as Pickett will dump it into the zone along the boards, handled by Kessler. Now Chevry struggles to hold on to it. Wilson, they're attacking Cook at center ice, and handled now by Bellamy. They almost lost it there. Bellamy passed it to Bolden, who knocked it into her own zone. They backtrack and will look to go on the attack. Bolden loses it along the boards to Beezer, and now Wilson tries to drive it into the Boston zone. Bellamy and Bolden behind the net. They've been on for a while now. Watch for the line changes. Pickett knocks it along the boards, but not out. Knocked out now past Bonham by Ashley Cottrell. Cook looked like she was looking for a rush there, but instead she goes off for a change, realizing that Brittany Smith was there to handle it. Smith now working against Buser, watching her closely. Bonham turns it over to Hillary Knight, the worst player to do that to. But they caught a break there. Now Bonham rushing into the Boston zone. Dostal knocks it back for Hillary Knight, and she stick handles her way around number 24 for Toronto. Of course, that is the ever dangerous Natalie Spooner behind the Toronto net. Hillary Knight back to the point. It's Wolfiler. Her shot goes wide, perhaps intentionally there. And now Kelly Stack handles it in the neutral zone, being watched closely by Kohanchuk. Stack with the pass to Knight. This top line out there for Boston, heading into the zone now is Wolfiler. She knocks it along the end boards, now backhands it back into the corner as Boston will change their forward line. Bonham's pass there went off of Jillian Dempsey. Kohanchuk battling along the boards. Behind the net, centering pass, dangerous. It gets stuffed between the stick and skate of Kessler, and it got knocked wide, but the play was whistled down before that happened. Kessler caught a break there as it looked like she mishandled what looked like a harmless pass towards the net.
And just before that, prior one led to this kerfuffle at the side of the net, if you will, was Bonham was playing the puck, and she sort of hesitated on the pass and played it off the shin pads of one of the Boston Blades player. And that led to the opportunity at the side of the net, was whistled down. A couple of perhaps quick whistles as far as Boston's concerned. I'm sure Digit Murphy isn't pleased.
Handling it behind the net for Toronto is Vela, up to number 9, Christy Zamora. Passes to Naslin. They handle it in the neutral. Passes to Naslin. They handle it in the neutral. Olson. Up to Jordana Perr. Handle the pass and it's intercepted by Bolden, who passes up to Berman. Lindsay Jordana Perr. Handle the pass and it's intercepted by Bolden, who passes up to Berman. Lindsay Berman. Handle the pass and it's intercepted by Bolden, who passes up to Berman. Intercepted by Bolden, who passes up to Berman. Lindsay Berman left it for Cardella, who battles. A centering pass went off the skate of Molson and wide. From behind the net there, as it's knocked out all the way down the ice into the Boston zone. It's going to be icing against the Furies with 13 minutes and 35 seconds remaining in the opening frame.
Going back to Blake Bolden for just a second there, we saw one of her passes a moment ago. It's almost borderline slap shot, slap pass material. She moves the puck effectively and quickly. And when you have to make decisions and read the play and quickly sort of take a snapshot and realize what to do with the puck, well, it's just ingrained in her. She is just a complete hockey player.
And yet again, a situation where a pass is backhanded against the near post, at least the post on the right side of Christina Kessler, where it looks like she struggled somewhat to locate it. And let's talk quickly about Christina Kessler, Anthony. We were talking to Coach Summer West before the game, and it looks like a timeout has already been called. Let's quickly discuss that once again. You got a really interesting quote from Summer West, and then we found out how it correlated directly to Christina Kessler with relation to what she told her players of their approach to this game.
Well, I asked her, what are you going to do? What sort of pregame speech? We both asked, pardon me, of Summer West, the coach of the year in the CWHL. You know, after she said, well, yeah, I slept like a baby last night, we said, are you nervous? What are you going to say to them? She said, what do I have to say? Well, we're here. And that was her quote. She said, we're here. This is the big game. It's all on the line here today. And I thought, we're here. Now, where have I heard something like that before? And you and I went behind the net and watched the warm-up on our way to talk to Digit Murphy. And then we looked at Kessler's mask. And right on the back written are the words, you are here. Very interesting, though, sort of the way that it echoes the coach's sentiment. We're here. Kessler's message, you are here. In other words, get yourself focused, be in the moment, sort of. And that's some words to live by, especially with the entire season on the line and the cup in the balance.
This is Toronto's second appearance in this, the sixth edition of the Clarkson Cup tournament. They were defeated in that game back in 2011 by Montreal in a 5-0 decision, obviously hoping for a better result here as Bucer knocks down Kohanchuk in the corner. She gets up quickly, but a penalty coming here. It will be the first power play of the game and a huge opportunity for the Toronto Furies. Bucer heads to the box.
Bucer is so effective. As you mentioned, all her goals are game-winning goals. She sports those bright red laces. She goes along the wall there, plays the body a little bit, and knocks her opponent down. She's in the box. I'm sure she's not happy in the least. One of the things we mentioned was the special teams. Toronto has to capitalize on the power plays. They've been handed opportunities in yesterday's game against Montreal. Boy, two full 2-minute five-on-threes back-to-back. Asked a lot of coaches and scramble play in front of the net there about that five-on-three situation back-to-backers. They've never seen it in the history. But still, Toronto doesn't really capitalize on their opportunities. They'd like to just relax a little bit.
They're going to have to relax here as Boston has done a pretty good job blocking their passing lanes, but now they're getting a little better effort here. Kohanchuk, Prevost, now to Smith in the corner. Spooner back to Smith at the point. Over to Spooner on the left wing. She couldn't quite handle the pass, but maintains possession. Smith at the line, working the umbrella. Back to Spooner. Spooner with the wrister tipped in front by, I believe that was Katie Wilson, and the save by Brittany Ott. She saw it all the way.
12 minutes, 25 seconds to go. And a minute 13 still on the power play as we get another look here at that shot as it made its way through. Ott is called the vacuum by Digit Murphy because she gathers up every puck around her like a Hoover.
She's done a real great job in this tournament picking up a shutout, as I mentioned earlier. Handling it is Megan Arts. Back to Bonello at the point to Tessa Bonhomme, the Olympian. Bonhomme, her pass nearly tipped by Hillary Knight, and now Knight almost had an opportunity to clear it, and instead Megan Arts unintentionally did it for her. Back to the neutral zone of the Furies. Corey Chevrier will dump it in and behind the net, handled by Ott. Pass there by Taverna, number 16. That was Ashley Cottrell. Tessa Bonhomme into the zone with Baldwin. Now behind the net, Bonhomme centering pass. What a chance by Megan Arts and a save by Brittany Ott. She came across from post to post and the save of the game so far.
It's pretty early here. Well, we're approaching the halfway mark of the first period, but three times Bonhomme has gotten engaged in the offensive side of things as a defender. Look at that. Sifts one right across the left pad of Ott, just makes a beautiful stop. Gathers, they had a couple of whacks, but pretty much one and done on a great feed from Bonhomme. She is dangerous offensively.
And once again, an example of Ott being the Hoover on that play, not allowing any sort of rebound despite a great opportunity. Spooner with a wrister blocked perfectly by Koizumi. Winding up with Smith, it's tipped. Puck is loose at the side of the net. Kohansha couldn't get to it, and it's dumped down the ice by Jill Dempsey. With 5 seconds remaining in the power play, Bucer is going to exit the box any moment now. And out she goes, 5-on-5 we are. 11-10 remaining in the first, a turnover in the Toronto zone. Kohanchuk now will clear it for Toronto. With some speed, Kohanchuk can fly. She heads to the slot, but great job by Cottrell to block her shooting lane. They battle at the in the corner, rather. It's dumped out of the zone into the center ice area. Nearly got knocked into the Toronto bench. And Prevost handles it for Toronto, being watched closely by Ashley Cottrell. Prevost leaves it back for Molson and now up to Wilson. It's backhanded, or at least an attempt to backhand it back into the zone, intercepted by Shannon Molson. She dumps it into the Boston zone. Bellamy handles it behind her own net, leaves it for Wolfeiler. And handled now by Toronto at the line. Bonello will dump it in, but it's intercepted. And now Carrie Matamo went after Wolfeiler. And Bucer will leave it for Kelly Stack. She heads in with some speed. Knight is with her on the left wing. The wrister kick save by Kessler. Great job there. She saw that play all the way and read it perfectly. They battle in the corner. It's Bucer. Left it there, and Perov nearly intercepted it. It just went off of the helmet of Wolfeiler as they continue to battle for it along the boards. A tight forechecking game so far, still scoreless as we've just passed the halfway mark of this opening period. Jordana Perov with the lead pass for Carrie Matamo is a little too lateral. Wasn't able to get enough forward motion on it, and they continue to battle for it in front of the Boston Blades bench. Hillary Knight backhands it into the Toronto zone. She goes off for a change, and onto the ice comes Dempsey, Koizumi, and Rachel Lannis. Lannis should be pretty fresh in this one. She sat out last night's game. A healthy scratch by Coach Murphy, knowing that her team really didn't have anything except for pride to play for yesterday. Zamora. That's Christy Zamora. Of course, both sisters play on this team. Dempsey with the pass across to Koizumi. Nice move around the defender. And handled in the corner. A penalty coming here against Toronto. As Dempsey handles it in the corner, now leaves it for Koizumi. They get the extra attacker. It's Kate Bucer. Bucer winds, fires, glove save by Christina Kessler. And she hangs on.
Bucer on the... the extra attacker on the ice as Ott quickly made her way to the bench, but they had to make sure who was getting the call. It took a few seconds, and then they realized here. And look at this. This is the opportunity earlier that Knight had. She calls for it. Stack realized that she's higher in the slot and hits Knight. Great little release, quick, low. And the great thing about that low shot is the goaltender can make the save, but more often than not, there's going to be a rebound kicked out. And there wasn't that instance right there as we have a look at Summer West. And her Chargers are going to have to kill off 2 minutes here. As headed to the box is Martine Garland.
As we await the call on this one, Garland will go to the box. And so the Boston Blades power play will get an opportunity here. They were so effective against the Inferno yesterday, scoring a power play goal so early in that game. And really, Anthony, the thing to look for on their power play attack are those quick, crisp, short passes that they do so effectively, really without any sort of windup, just tape-to-tape, quick passing, almost one-timers.
One-touch passes, sort of, if you will, just quick puck movement. That can negate a very good penalty kill. And the Furies are out here with Spooner to kill off the penalty, taking the draw. But this is the big line, Stack, Bucer, Knight.
Smith Beezer, Bonhomme, and Spooner on the ice, penalty killing for the Toronto Furies at the line. She skates in bold and great pass to Knight. She hesitated just a little too long trying to get clean possession of that puck, and Brittany Smith will leave it for Natalie Spooner. She heads into the zone shorthanded. Some nice defense there and a clean play by Casey Bellamy, playing her opponent there with getting the puck loose but not taking a penalty on the play. Hillary Knight with a great move from her knees, but she couldn't get enough strength behind the shot, and Kessler turned it aside easily. Buser back to the point to Blake Bolden. Back to Buser. At the side of the net, the pass across. Great defense by Spooner. She got her stick just in front of that pass. Otherwise, Kelly Stack would have had a great shot as Bolden in a foot race with Prevost. But Bolden got there first and got it to Casey Bellamy. A couple quick rushes the other way. The Furies clearly trying to take some chances against a very tough opponent in the Blades.
Hillary Knight had a great opportunity earlier, but Tessa Bonhomme tied up her stick at the side of the net. She had to settle down the puck, Knight, though, and didn't get the shot she wanted.
Dempsey behind the net, being watched very closely by Shannon Molson. Now Koizumi back to number four. That's Cardella for the Blades. Now back to the point. It's Wolfiler, Alyssa Wolfiler. Back to Cardella, behind the net to Koizumi. Koizumi looking for someone to center it to. Back to the point. Koizumi, as there are 30 seconds remaining, the shot went just wide of the net. Should clarify, that's 23 seconds remaining in the power play. Just over 7 minutes remaining in the first period. Cardella lifted the shot, went just high and wide of the net. And now handled by number 10, Lindsay Berman, looking for an opportunity. Power play winding down with 8 seconds left. Wolfiler to Cardella. Cardella with a weak pass intercepted in front of the net by Shannon Molson, but they can't get it out. Wolfiler, wrister, and one of the easiest saves probably for Kessler in this game. She gloves it easily and hangs on.
Well, the right side defender there, they had two right-handed defensemen there, Wolfiler and Dosdell. And Dosdell pinched down the right side wall, the far side wall, and kept the play alive. It looked like an easy clearing attempt for the Furies. And Dosdell said, you know what, I'm going to pinch down and see if I can keep this play alive. Did, and it led to a shot on net.
Regardless of how powerful that shot was, it was an effective one nonetheless. Every shot counts. You can't score if you don't shoot it, as Katie Wilson handles it along the sideboards, but it's intercepted at center ice by Bellamy. Heading into the zone is Cottrell, centering pass, and Cook fired it just wide, as she was watched very nicely by the Toronto defender, and a tip by Pickett went high and over the net, into the netting, and out of play.
Just a tale of two different teams right now, and it's early in the game, of course, 6:16 to go here in the first period, but one noticed that when Toronto had their power play, was killed off by Boston, they seemed to get some energy. They got a power play. They didn't back off at all. This play is still to our left. It's really Boston that are doing all and maintaining all the pressure and have all the momentum for the time being.
Bolden with a point shot. It was tipped right on net, and Kessler did a nice job redirecting it wide of the net, not allowing a rebound. Nice two-line pass up to Buser. Winds up behind the net, but Brittany Smith there to defend. Being watched closely by Stack, that top line out there for the Blades. There's Kohanchuk, watched by Bellamy. Knight now battling along the boards, as they have so much. Bonhomme winds up with it, and she passes back to her defense partner, Brittany Smith. Back to Bonhomme. Bonhomme along the sideboards, intercepted at the line and kept in by Knight, but now Spooner heads in with some speed. Natalie Spooner, watch out for her wheels. A shot turned aside by Ott, and the rebound was mishandled by Megan Arts. Otherwise, she would have had a golden opportunity to open the scoring here with 5:32 remaining in the first.
Coming down the natural wing, Spooner with some great foot speed. Look at her. She cuts wide, but she goes back against the grain, goes long side, blocker down. The rebound's there, but look at that. We're calling it the black hole, that left hand of Ott. She reaches down and denies another opportunity. Good shot on net nonetheless, though, but no opportunity there for anything to transpire there as Ott settles things down right away, as she's done time and time again throughout the regular season, and especially here in the 2014 Clarkson Cup.
As it just went off of Ott's shoulder,
Now, it's not being timeouts called, my friend. We have TV coverage as well here in Canada. So the TV timeout, and that's why the red light is on in the box to tell the officials we get a little bit of time. Gives the teams a chance to talk over strategy. We are a bit kerfuffled as we hadn't seen that thus far throughout the week, but I just recognized it now and realized that's what they were doing, and that's why everybody went to the bench and a good chance to talk things over. They didn't get this luxury throughout the round robin.
No, absolutely, and that would, of course, explain that earlier situation where we thought there was a timeout call. There was likely a team timeout as well. So I was trying to think, as the players went over to the bench, it seems a bit odd that both teams would use their only timeout of the game in the first period in a scoreless game, but now we have that situation explained. So the faceoff will be taken here between Jill Dempsey for the Blades and for Toronto, Alyssa Baldwin. 5:32 remaining in the opening period. Bonello throws it at the net. It's tipped, and Ott covers it up before anybody could get an opportunity.
Chevry taking a little shove there. I believe it's Dostal doing the honors. Yeah, it is, and they're lining up against one another and having a few words.
Face-off won by the Toronto Furies. Bonello with another try for the point shot. It's blocked in a flurry of skates. And now behind the net, it is thrown to the other side. Chevry there to help out. Knocks into Maggie Taverna. And handled by Bonello. Taverna winds up back with it in her own zone. Backtracking against Prevo. Koizumi carries it into the zone. The Blades captain leaves it along the boards, hoping it got to Lannis. But Chevry anticipated the play perfectly. Gave Lannis a shove, and they never got it. Now handling it at center ice is Maggie Taverna. Intercepted at center ice by Christy Samora, and back to Shannon Molson. Bonello, the assistant captain for Toronto, up to Peroff. Jordana Peroff working against Bellamy. Gets some help from Vella. Jessica Vella in the corner, looking for someone to pass to. Back to the point. Martine Garland throws it at the net, tipped perfectly by Whitney Naslund as it landed right at her feet, and the Blades are able to clear it out.
Some nice hand-eye coordination right there by Naslund, wasn't it?
No, it's not too often you see a play like that where there's no body in front of the puck, as number 11 for Boston, Whitney Naslund, took a spill there right in front of Kessler. She's all right. Looked as though she just slipped a little bit. Bolden with the point shot and sucked in by Christina Kessler.
You want an example of how hard Bolden can shoot the puck and why she breaks so many sticks in practice? And I asked Digit Murphy, we did actually, we said, does it cost you guys a little bit more because she's breaking all the twigs? And she said, no, I'm not sure where she gets them, but she can break as many as she wants. Just an incredible slap shot as we saw the replay. That is just an absolute bullet off the right side point. She's got a tremendous shot, tremendous vision. Her passes are like they come with a GPS because they always get to the intended target. There's none of this recalculating.
Turn left at blue line.
That's right.
Kelly Stack threw it behind the net to Bucer. The centering pass on the wraparound, but nobody got to it. Casey Bellamy dumps it into the corner for Knight. Stack there to help out. Spooner covered her perfectly, and Bonhomme winds up with it. And a pass up to Megan Arts. Arts over to Kohanchuk. Kohanchuk and Arts on a bit of a two-on-two chance and held onto by Brittany Ott. And not even the most normal glove save you'll see. She caught that right at her skates.
The Hoover, you mean? The vacuum cleaner. She just takes everything up and gathers it up into the gear.
Or the Dirt Devil. We don't want to give too much credit to us.
To one company.
Yeah. That is not an official sponsor. And, of course, we welcome any vacuum company that wants to sponsor Brittany Ott or the Boston Blades next season. The doors are wide open as Bonello with the pass to Katie Wilson. Wilson heads into the corner, throws it at the net. Puck is loose in front, but three Boston defenders were there and nobody on Toronto could get a stick on it.
Beezer was knocked down in the slot there. Good job there defensively by the Blades.
And not drawing a penalty as well, as Bonello carries it through the neutral zone with 3 minutes remaining in the opening period. We're still scoreless. You're watching the 2014 Clarkson Cup Championship presented by Scotiabank. Asher Roth, Anthony Regan, and Sarah Wright on the sidelines. Here with you on the Streaming Sports Network website. Dumped into the Toronto zone by Dostal and handled by Bonello. Shannon Molson with a nice backhander along the boards and left it for Bonello up to Holly Carey-Matimo. Carey-Matimo left it in the neutral zone, intercepted by Bellamy. an Olympian in her own right for Team USA. Pickett with an attempted shot blocked by Bonello. It's tipped on net. Puck was loose in front, but Bonello saw it perfectly. And Toronto will carry it out of the zone. Chevry. And she couldn't quite handle that pass. Bellamy knocked it out and down the ice. Kessler will handle it. 2 minutes remaining in the first. Brought into the Boston zone, but handled by Bellamy. And she'll make the pass up to Kelly Stack. And here's that Boston top line out there in the final couple minutes of this period. Intercepted by Stack. She waits. Oh, what a save by Christina Kessler. Oh, my. She dangled that one, waited for so long. And Kessler with a great save.
Oh, this is just unreal, because what an opportunity for Stack. Walks right out in front with the puck. Goes wide, tries to get the goaltender to commit, tries to go cross crease, and does. It goes upstairs looking for something on the netminder, but Kessler's glove was right there. This is going to be another goaltender's battle again.
Christina Kessler with the save of the tournament, especially if you count the circumstance that it was made, a scoreless game and the championship game at that. Along the boards, that top line still out there for Boston, working against Megan Arts and Kohanchuk. So Toronto answering back with their own top line. Now Bucer gets it free and a whistle. Yeah. And it's going to be a hand pass for Boston.
Bucer earlier, she had the most effective pass, I think, of the game. She was on the right when she came around the net right there. She sifted one back through everybody, went right through the blue ice. Nobody was home for Boston, but Toronto wasn't even aware of themselves as that puck went right through past everybody. It was a terrific, sneaky centering pass to get to the front of the net, but nobody, well, neither team able to realize that Bucers are going to do that.
Toronto wins the faceoff cleanly. Chevry tips it into the Boston zone, handled behind the net by Ott. She has to watch out as Perroff was skating towards her with speed. Now Chevry behind the net, Perroff there to help out. Bellamy handles it. Leaves it for Bolden. Bolden with a nice behind-the-back pass to Jill Dempsey. Up to Koizumi. Back to Dempsey. They worked the give-and-go. Nearly went offside there. Koizumi did a great job staying onside as Bellamy got knocked down and now skates right off. Believe she's all right. It was just a line change. Bolden handles it in the Boston zone. We're in the final minute. That was Dempsey on the bench. Hoping she's all right. Spooner now carries it into the Boston zone. Fires it. Nice easy pad save by Ott. Redirected into the corner. 30 seconds remaining in the first. Megan Arts at the point. Shoots it behind the net. Bellamy battling against Spooner. Spooner so dangerous. And Kohanchuk there to help out along with Megan Arts. Stack shoves her along the boards. 20 seconds remaining. It winds up in front of the net. Bellamy carries it out for Boston. And through the neutral zone. Dumps it into the Toronto zone. Trying to kill some clock. With the period winding down, 10 seconds remaining. Brittany Smith carries it out for Toronto, looking for one more rush, but instead she'll turn it over at the neutral zone, and that will do it for the opening period of play. It's the Toronto Fury 0, the Boston Blades 0, and listen to the showing of appreciation by this Markham Centennial Center crowd.
Dempsey's up, and she seems to be okay. She just came out, but she had a collision, as you said, and then went right off, and she was hustling off, but she looked uncomfortable. She sat down with her back to the other players, and even the coaching staff were busy watching the play to their left, and then they looked down to the right to see how Jillian Dempsey, the rookie of the year in the CWHL, was doing. She appears, for now anyway, to be just fine. She came out. She's skating through center right now, but she's testing her leg right now. See number three, she's going around. She twisted something perhaps a little. She's just doing a few moves out there to see how she looks. Quite fine the way she's testing it, so I wouldn't be surprised if she's back in the second and the third.
If we still see her there, she will likely be the last one off for the Boston Blades. And now here she goes, as it looks like she's tested her ankles sufficiently. Meanwhile, that will do it for this first period. 0-0 the score. Let's head down to Sarah Wright in the studio.
Thank you, gentlemen. I'm here with the head coach of the Calgary Inferno, who is watching upstairs very closely. Tim Bothwell, thanks for joining me. First of all, we just watched the first period. Do you see either team having an edge so far?
I think Boston had a tiny territorial edge, and Kess in the net for Toronto, two real good saves in the last 5 minutes, but otherwise a fairly even period. I'm sure Toronto were very happy with the period and just to get through it and not be down, and it's going to be a real dogfight by the looks of it.
Absolutely, it has been so far, the whole tournament, really. Speaking of the tournament, 0-3, not exactly the result you guys wanted for your first appearance at the Clarkson Cup, but there's got to be a lot of positives to take from this week.
Well, there certainly are. For starters, I thought we played really, really well in the most important game. Well, they're all important, but the Montreal game, which was the game that we really needed to win to keep us alive, we probably played our best game. We know if we give up a power play goal against Montreal, our odds of winning are greatly reduced because they're very good in the power play and they live on it in lots of ways. And we gave up two in the end, which we can't. But I was really happy with the heart and the determination we showed in all the games. I thought in the first game against Toronto, terrific start. Absolutely ecstatic about the first 15 minutes. And then, you know, a couple of tough penalties for us that got Toronto untracked, and then we got stuck in the mud a bit. But very happy on balance with our performance. Would like to have won a game or two.
Absolutely. But your girls have been some of the classiest girls that I've talked to, some of the classiest athletes that I've ever interviewed. Is that a good example of them on their day-to-day, year-to-year type of personality?
They're great people. They really are. I'd like to say it's a Western, the Western thing, but we've got a bunch of girls from Ontario as well. I have a small handful, but they're just terrific people. I've really enjoyed the experience in working with them, and we came a long, long way this year from 3-7 just before Christmas, and put a great second half together. So I'm very proud of what they did in the second half.
The girls both, or they all said that the team never quits, and that's obvious. They made it here after that slower start. Speaking of a start, you were coach for Team Canada or assistant coach for Team Canada back in 2006, and now you're here at the Clarkson Cup. How has it been watching the evolution of women's hockey?
Very exciting. You know, I started with Hockey Canada 10 years ago, and right off the top, I mean, the level of talent and skill has steadily risen over those 10 years. The depth of the player pool, again, steadily risen, and we certainly can say the same for the U.S. But it's been very exciting, and this experience this week has really been an eye-opener for me in lots of ways. Lots of good conversations with Brenda, our commissioner, and Brad Morris, who's done a terrific job organizing this event, and they've got everything pointed in the right direction, and I'm really excited to see where this league might be in 5 years.
Me too. It has been a great week. Thanks for joining me. Go join your team in the lounge. Gentlemen, take it back.
And welcome back to the booth. Asher Roth here alongside Anthony Regan. A great first period. 8-8 the shot, 0-0 the score. What really stood out for you in that one?
There's a couple of moments, a couple of great moments, and we're back to that old goaltender's duel. For me, so far, it was Kelly Stack right on the doorstep where she walked out and she had Christina Kessler in a very precarious situation. She's alone in front of the net. The defenders sort of split and were engaged in other areas, sort of. And Kelly Stack walks out. She takes a look and she tries to stretch, go wide, and she fires the shot. And Christina Kessler gets that left glove out and gobbles it up and takes away a grade A scoring opportunity. There was chances around the net for both clubs. That was the primo, the number one opportunity for both these clubs right there. 10-9, the shots favoring the Toronto Furies. I'm not sure who's keeping the shots, actually, because it looked to me, and it looked to the head coach of the Calgary Inferno, Tim Bothwell, who just did a great interview there, that indeed Boston seems to have the edge. They were energized. They had a power play opportunity off the heels of Toronto killing that off. Boston maintained the pressure, kept up the momentum, and kept the pressure. And a lot of times the puck was in Toronto's zone. That's exactly what Digit Murphy wants, because you're not going to be scored upon as long as that pressure stays down in the other team's zone.
And they certainly seemed dangerous every time that Boston Blades top line was out there. If Hillary Knight, Kate Buser, and Kelly Stack, every time they were out there, they were generating speed, scoring chances, and all sorts of danger for Christina Kessler. But boy, did she ever hold her ground. Now, on the other side of it, Brittany Ott, no slouch herself, a great period for her.
she's always focused and in charge, and it seems, is the term unflappable okay to use in hockey? Because that's the way she seems. She never looks rattled. Even when it seems there's chaos reigning, bodies flying, she's focused on the puck. And the ability for a goaltender to track a puck through any type of condition, Ott's got that in spades, and that's just a tremendous compete level by the netminder Ott. She finds everything. We saw on a centering pass, she used the paddle of her stick to knock one down. It was about a foot off the air, going to the front of the net. Would have been a great chance for somebody to tap one home. Ott says, you know what? Out of there you go, like a ping pong paddle. Knocked it away, covers up, and doesn't allow anybody any opportunity. So if you're going to score on Ott, you're going to have to beat her cleanly, and it's going to have to be a goal because she does not give up many rebounds, and she certainly doesn't give up many goals glove side. She has an excellent left hand. I was calling it the black hole of hockey.
And that really has actually been the key. I think you could agree with me, Anthony, that the goaltending in this tournament has been solid all yes. around, even by the eliminated teams. But really, the biggest difference has been the rebound control. That was the biggest problem that the Stars had in Catherine Herron specifically. She made a lot of the initial saves, but she struggled with that second shot. Now, Sarah Wright did talk to Coach Tim Bothwell for Calgary. Obviously staying extremely positive despite the result, his team going 0-3. And it's so fantastic to see really just the positive attitude by everybody throughout this tournament, but especially for the Calgary players.
Yeah, well, the Calgary players are here for the first time at the Clarkson Cup. It's their first appearance. They traveled the furthest to get here. And they're here now, and they wanted everybody to know that we're here. In the game last night, talking to the head coaches, Tim Bothwell was saying, I'm very proud of the way we've played, and we've competed, and we're in every game. And even though we're up against a team that is now very favored, Boston went 3-0 after beating Calgary last night, he said, we are in every game, and their compete level. Calgary, there's an opportunity there. Okay, we lost our two games. We were in them, but we lost them. Now we're in the third game. There's not a lot on the line except pride. You could fold your tents and say, you know what? We tried our best. Desjardins got the start last night for the Inferno, gave up a few quick early goals. It might have been a case of, oh, my goodness, let's think about the plane ride home or back. What's waiting for us back in the hotel room. None of that. Stone and company just kept plugging away, chipping away, and they just, to their credit, just kept trying to get back into the game, even though it was, by and large, almost out of reach because the goals were coming fast and furious. I mean, four alone by Hillary Knight is enough to, you know, scare a lot of clubs. They just kept competing right to the end. They did not quit. They did not back off. They might have been outmatched, but they didn't know it themselves, and they didn't care whether they were or not. And that's a sign of a very healthy hockey club. They compete. And I'll tell you, one of the problems they were having was the physicality. They were playing, and they said in an interview, Hockey Canada sent an interview package down to us, and one of the Calgary players was saying, We were bumping and grinding and throwing a lot of body checks out there. That's the way we play. We play a lot of male teams, and the guys aren't going to back off on you. So the Calgary Inferno is taking a page from the way they're playing against the guys by throwing a few more checks than maybe they should, and that can lead you into, as we know, in a non-contact league, or there's no body checking in the league. There is plenty of contact that can make it difficult for teams, especially when you start running into handing the other team power play opportunities. When the extra attacker's on the ice, a team like Boston, when they have an extra attacker, man, they know how to deal with it.
That really does raise an interesting point. The Calgary Inferno really did take more penalties in total than the rest of the league. You can see that just by looking at their season stats. Two players with over 40 minutes in penalties compared to some teams that don't even have nothing. Coach Bothwell called a very quick timeout. Really the first action-filled first period we've seen with regards to high-scoring games. All the goals were in the first period. A lot of quiet first periods where teams feel each other out. And you mentioned that physicality that Boston has done so well. We really didn't see a ton of it, at least not blatant physicality, and really only one penalty each, I believe, on either side. They really tried to get some flow going on offense and play a strong forecheck instead of going for the big hit.
And you talked about the passing and especially the quick passing by Boston. Yeah, passing is it starts at the back end with somebody like Bolden. She can lug the puck if she needs to. If she doesn't, if she's looking up ice and she's seeing all the lanes are covered and she doesn't have a and gets to center and does something, and she always makes something happen with the puck. But when she does find she's got an outlet pass, you better have two hands on your stick and be ready, because that puck is coming at you like a bullet, and it's very accurate. It's tape to tape passes. When she gets the puck on the back end, boy, she can unload towards the net as well. So, yeah, physicality. Buser took the first penalty of the game, and it was for body checking tight along the boards down below. She finished her check. But, yeah, they killed off that penalty, and they haven't looked back. They have to give the edge in the play in that first 20 minutes of action to the Boston Blades. Digit Murphy, you know, she hasn't made any adjustments for the game except putting in, as you said off the top, Lannis back into the lineup. But does she really need to have to make any adjustments, especially with that top line and countering the top line for Summer West? You've got Spooner, Arts, and Kohanchuk out there as well. So every time you see those red laces of Buser hit the ice, trust me, Spooner's coming over the boards as well.
Now, we want to quickly dive into the Twitter conversation, because it's been such a great theme throughout the week. Anthony, you were with the other broadcaster. You haven't quite gotten a handle on just what a huge impact the Twitter sphere has had on us and my broadcast partner for the rest of the week, Nico Cardarelli. You can, of course, follow me on Twitter, at The Asheroth. Anthony is at Little Antony.
Antony R.
I can't read it. Little Antony R. So that's at @LittleAntnyR. Of course, Sarah Wright, our sideline reporter, at Sarah Wright S3. Feel free to ask us any questions. We will answer them during the period and any breaks in play. It's great to hear from you. We've had some viewership all around the world, Australia, Brazil, England, all throughout the United States. All of you fans out there supporting the Boston Blades, Toronto Furies, Montreal Stars, Calgary Inferno. So great to see, and we thank all of you and encourage you to interact with us.
The Clarkson Cup is named after Adrienne Clarkson, who was here. She tweeted yesterday that if you can't come out to the game, because let's face it, there's only so many seats here in the Markham Arena. Lovely facility, mind you. However, it's pretty much sold out. She said if you can't get down here and take it in person, you can follow it live, courtesy of SSN. And I've been following you guys, of course, and seeing all the comments from around the world. And it's absolutely outstanding, and it's amazing, the audience for women's hockey. Great compete level out there, and two terrific clubs. All four clubs here at the Clarkson have been outstanding. And I felt a little sad for Montreal yesterday. They were such great sports. They were having a bit of fun. They were really lively. Somebody was doing an interview. They put a pinata behind the head of one of the reporters here. You know what? Sports is fun. You're supposed to have fun at the end of the day. You're supposed to compete hard, take it seriously, but at the end of the day, have a little fun. You're not performing heart surgery. You are playing a game, and you know, when you boil it all down. And it seems the Montreal Stars, they have their egos in check, as all the teams do. They've been very forthcoming, but it felt sad that two teams had to bow out of this, but that's the way it works. And the two teams that are remaining, boy, they're great clubs.
I don't know about you. I was told that I was performing heart surgery entering this one. I'm going to have to put my scalpel away as we get ready for second period action.
I thought you were the head anesthesiologist, but that's a different story for another time.
Oh,
and the
boy.
Shots 10-9, favoring the Furies. And I think a lot of those, though, were just pucks that made it to the net that Ott just covered up.
No, a real effective first period for both netminders and the defense in front of them. And you know that the defense for the Toronto Furies specifically, that top pairing of Tessa Bonhomme and Brittany Smith, are going to want to tighten up a little bit in front of Christina Kessler to prevent opportunities like that one by Kelly Stack late in that first period, forcing Kessler to make an unbelievable save. But obviously, Anthony, you can't rely on show-stopping saves or assume that you're going to get them every single time.
No, just looking around the arena, too. I mean, we were talking about the fact that there's a lot of people here. Look at all the railbirds in the top on the other side. There's a couple of seats, but they're the seats at the end of the arena where you don't get the best view. And those are typically where the scouts are going to have a seat and take, you know, take in the action, because they can see everything. But, boy, they're packed shoulder to shoulder. They're too deep at the end glass. And this is exactly what these women want to see. The Clarkson Cup is on the line. It's here in the building. I followed it in. and the fans followed it in as well. We've got a lot of shirts here as well. I'm seeing some Boston shirts throughout the building. Cross over there on the far side in the standing rail, there's a Boston jersey, some fans, there's Montreal jerseys for the Stars as well, and even a Spooner jersey over here, a guy's wearing just down below us. He's also got a Furies hat on. And there is some sweaters and hats and game jerseys and everything available to be available for purchase here. So they thought of everything, the CWHL, huh?
And, of course, interesting to note, so I look at that Natalie Spooner jersey over to our right. It's a number 5 that the fan is wearing. That was her number in previous years. But since she left this season to join the Olympic roster, the number 5 was given to Alora Kears, who's not playing in this game. So Spooner took number 24, just one number less than her Canadian teammate, Tessa Bonhomme. They battle for it along the side boards as the second period's underway, 25 seconds in to be exact. You're watching the 2014 Clarkson Cup. It's presented by Scotiabank on the SSN Canada Network. That one tipped nearly on the point shot by Bonhomme. And another shot thrown at the net. Arts couldn't quite get her stick on it as it was just a little bit up in the air. It's heading all the way down the ice for icing against the Boston Blades. And luckily for Toronto that pass had a little too much behind it because Hillary Knight nearly had a breakaway.
Yeah, Corey Chevry was trying to mark her, but Knight was by and far gone. She was almost in the snack bar. She was so far down the ice. But the puck didn't reach her, so no harm, no foul right there. But their back enders for the Furies are going to have to be very aware every time Knight's out on the ice, and she's got it now.
It's funny to hear Miley Cyrus's Party in the USA just playing. That, I'm sure, will be the theme song if Boston can come up victorious in this one as Bucer carries it in. A pass in front for Bolden, couldn't get her stick on it, and the shot went wide. Battling behind the net now that I believe that's Spooner. No, it's Bolden. Winds up with it. And that was Bonello. Hard to see here between 4, 14, and 24. I believe it was Natalie Spooner. We'll have to double check that. Or maybe Shannon Molson. Either way.
It was Molson in back of the net there, whose brother plays in the NHL, Matt Molson. She was a scratch earlier in the week, so that's probably why we didn't notice her as much.
No, and I was actually trying to look that up before the tournament to see if there was any relation between Shannon and Matt Molson, so that's pretty cool to find out. As it's handled at the side by Bellamy. Back to the point, the shot went wide, and Koizumi tried to get it, and now it's dumped out by Prevost for Toronto. And all the way down the ice, Ott leaves it for Dostal. Decided against leaving her crease as Dostal was easily able to handle it. Beezer handling it for Toronto. She, of course, left the game against Montreal yesterday with an apparent leg injury, but it's great to see her back here today playing in arguably or easily the biggest game of the year for the Furies.
That was the biggest surprise for everybody here in the building is when Beezer showed up in between the games because she left in an ambulance. The cameras were tied in on her face yesterday when she was on the bench after blocking a shot, and we thought she had a broken foot. She went away for x-rays, was tended to, came back, was asked, are you going to be in the game? She said, oh, yeah.
So fantastic to see some of these players returning from apparent injuries. Kohanchuk did as well a couple days ago. She went down and
Kneecap,
and it really didn't look good as she they had the training bag out and everything. They had to help her all the way across to the dressing room, and it really didn't look good for her, but she came back the next period. So it really says a ton about the perseverance of these players as Pickett carries it in for Boston, leaves it for Doster Cottrell, and Kessler sucks it right in and covers up.
Yeah, Kessler, as you can see from where she's standing right there, she's out above the blue ice of the crease. She's well out in front. The shot came, and she gathered it up into the midsection. It actually hit the middle O in the word Toronto. And she was made the easy stop there. But they get the offensive zone draw, do the Blades.
Behind the net, they battle. It's Kate Bucer and Brittany Smith. Toronto wins that battle for now. But now Hillary Knight winds up with it, still in the Toronto zone, handled in front. Bucer left it for Stacks. So dangerous that line is, but they couldn't get a shot away. Megan Arts carries it for Toronto now, winds and fires, and gloved by Brittany Ott on her blocker side, and she hangs on.
This is the first time I think I've seen Ott not fully cleanly play the puck with that left hand of hers there. She had to sort of use the blocker to you know, make sure she held it on, but held on to the puck. But again, the real tale of the tape is the fact that there was no rebound given up. I mean, it's one and done every time when Ott's handling the puck, as Chevry comes in to have some words off the draw to Baldwin.
And for those of you at home wondering why Brittany Ott wears those baby blue pads and helmet, comes from her days in the University of Maine. Representing her old school, pretty cool to see. Giving these fans up here in Markham a little bit of exposure from south of the border. And Alyssa Baldwin's going to take this faceoff against, it was Kelly Stack, but she gets kicked out of the faceoff circle, and Buser will win the faceoff and get it to Dostal. Corey Chevry lost it tonight, and now handled by Stack, brings it into the Toronto zone. Kelly Stack with some speed, the centering pass, and she couldn't quite get a shot away, was Kate Buser. Some great defense there, and I believe a poke check by Kessler, preventing Buser from getting a quality chance. Bonhomme passes back to Brittany Smith, up to Prevost. Prevost to Chevry. It went right off the number on her back.
Yeah, it did.
Not something you see very often, but she still managed to keep it relatively out of harm's way. But now Bolden carries it in offside for Boston.
Yeah, Dempsey was on the left wing side, and if she's just a little too quick, as Bolden cut over. Okay, keep an eye on Tessa Bonhomme. She's a defender for Toronto. Same thing with this young lady on the screen right there, the talented Ms. Bolden. They both engage. They don't, you know, they're not waiting for something to happen. They go down and they're like, I know I'm supposed to be responsible for keeping the puck out of my net, but I can darn well put it into the other team's net as well, as both defenders make sure they get in. I've seen them in on the rush many times now.
Blake Bolden, a defender, had 19 points in 23 games for the Blades this season, including 5 goals, and she also led them in penalty minutes with 44. Christy Zamora battles at center ice with Koizumi. Then she hit the boards hard with her stick. You could hear it all the way from up here. Bellamy up to Koizumi. She loses it to Bonello at the point. They get it out, and now carried up the ice is Jordana Peroff. Peroff looking for help. Gets it, and that shot went just wide by Jessica Vella. Shannon Molson at the point. Winds and fires the rebound. And covered up by Aaron Rather. No, it went, ended up loose and behind the net, and Boston carries it out. They caught a break there. Casey Bellamy dumps it into the Toronto zone. They get wholesale changes here.
Vella was dumped right in the right in front of Ott, actually, there. Is going for the rebound. Good non-call by the officials here. They're letting the ladies on the ice decide the outcome of this game. Just two penalties so far. Hooking and body checking, one apiece.
Great to see there as Wolfeiler fanned on a passing, a clearing attempt, and the crowd was all over it. And they battle for it in that neutral zone. Cardella carries it in for Boston. They still battle along the boards. Great job there by Martin Garland, preventing Boston from being able to get it out. Once again in the neutral zone, and backtracking is Jill Cardella. Cardella watched closely by Spooner. Kohanchuk now up to Megan Arts. Arts carries it in. She dumps it into the corner behind the net, behind Ott. Wolfeiler loses it. Now Ott trying to stand her ground there, watching as Megan Arts charged behind the net. Kohanchuk looking for the pass. It's dumped once again behind the net. Giving chase is Megan Arts with Wolfeiler, but kept in at the point by Brittany Smith. Smith in front to Kohanchuk. Spooner was buzzing around the net for the rebound, but couldn't get her stick on it. And what speed she had as soon as she saw that. She pounced for that puck. Cardella knocks it along the boards, but Smith intercepts it in the neutral zone and backtracks into her own zone with Bonhomme. Up to Kohanchuk. Carried in by Spooner. Watch out. But some great defense there by Alyssa Wolfeiler to knock it away. Still battling behind the net. Now back to the point. Bonhomme can't keep it in. And it's going to go all the way down the ice. An icing call against Boston with 13:36 remaining in the second period.
You and I, no surprise here as we take a look at this here. Goes back to the point. Molson gets the shot. Watch the rebound. Low shot. There's the rebound. There's Vella going down. No penalty on the play, thank goodness. There is. There may have been a call there against Casey Bellamy. None coming. None deserved.
Now Bellamy did a great job as Chevry wired that one just wide on the blocker side of Brittany Ott. Hillary Knight up to Stack, heading in with speed, but a great defensive play there by Baldwin. And now they hack away at it, does Chevry and Whitney Naslund. Baldwin carries it in. Knight just stayed onside. A pass across to Buser. She fires. Great save, and the rebound in front as Kessler kicked it right in front, but handled cleanly by Baldwin. Baldwin will lob it into the corner. Prevost gives chase with Bolden behind the net. Bolden maintains possession. What a job she did there. Such strength. And look at her speed now. Carries it corner to corner. Gets taken down by Molson. No call on the player, in fact. And we're going to wait to see what happens here.
I think the net's off its moorings, my friend. And it is there. Well, that's a good call. How about Bolden, though, eh? She gets the puck and she just decides. As I said, she looks up ice, decides, I don't like what I see. She just throws it into gear, and she's got about six of them, trust me. She's got overdrive, actually two overdrive gears. And she gets down ice. She was met and dealt roughly with by, I think it was Jessica Vella who gave her a rough time as she went flying up in the air there and landed heavily. We have a TV timeout here again, so a little time for them to regroup. What do you think Summer West said to the Toronto Furies? Because after a first period that I'd say was 60-40 in favor of Digit Murphy's Blades, this one here, Toronto seems to have sort of tipped the scales more in their favor. It's put a balance about 50-50 in my estimation, my friend. Good chances at both ends of the ice.
Now you definitely have to think that she told them to take a couple more chances offensively. And we've really seen the speed of Spooner. But on the other side, Blake Bolden there with some great jets carrying it into the Toronto zone. And Toronto got lucky that the net was knocked off. All right, Anthony.
Yes.
We've named you on Twitter.
Oh, no.
And you're already starting to get some feedback.
I'm not sure what to do. I do apologize. I don't think anybody's interested. What's the feedback?
At Celeste Upsamath says, welcome to Twitter, Anthony.
Thank you so kind. I was waiting for an insult. So
no,
thank
see,
you.
It's been all positive feedback this week.
Oh, that's true.
And it's really been fantastic to see. At Bessie Boo saying, oh my God, I would love a Minnesota team so much. Seriously, where do I donate to Kickstarter? We were talking about expansion. And so it's great to keep that up. Of course, once again, send us your tweets if you have any ideas for where the CWHL could expand in a purely hypothetical sense, of course, because we obviously don't have any control over that.
But your control that you do have is showing support. And she's saying, where do I contribute? Well, that's showing support right there and helping the cause indeed. Minnesota, whoa! That was dangerously in front of Kessler, who gloved it and held on. It was chopped in the air. There are ways to contribute and help out. You go to the CWHL website, you'll find it out under sponsorship and opportunities, etc.
Here's an interesting stat as well from at Dr. Crankite. The, quote, Hoover Dirt Devil Brittany Ott once made 72 saves against Boston College.
Are you kidding me?
So
72? That's games worth of saves.
Maybe three. Just unbelievable.
True. We're talking Timbits hockey, which is where they let the little tiny ones come out. And they were doing that during the week here in the round robin. They had two Timbits games, which are little tiny hockey players, about 5-6 years of age, just when players are starting to get into it. They had the girls out playing on the game, and then in the pregame skate, they had a little goaltender and one of the forwards out as well, helping to take part. And I'm telling you, as a dad, I was getting all choked up.
It was great to see it. Everyone in the crowd, including the broadcast crews, were cheering on the kids in between games. It was really fun to witness as we're witnessing this second period action between Toronto and Boston in the championship game of the Clarkson Cup. A shot on net went just wide by number 3, Jill Dempsey. Handled in the neutral zone by Cook, nearly turned over, and Beezer smelled fire there. She was looking for that puck. Turned on the jets and then had to backtrack.
Yeah, she just chipped it to herself just a little too far. Her eyes were probably as big as saucers when she saw the opportunity, but Boston recovered.
If only we could have seen a close-up. A nice lead pass to Whitney Naslin, but she will dump it in as the Blades will go off for a change. Wholesale changes for Boston here with 11:45 remaining in the second period. This is the 2014 Clarkson Cup, intercepted by Bolden! And she fired it just off of the right arm of Kessler. Play still going on here as it's knocked out by the Furies. A nice defensive job by Christy Zamora. It goes all the way down the ice, but no icing call as Bolden gave chase. What an opportunity there for Blake Bolden right in front of the Toronto net. And they're going to have to watch their defensive coverage, as I don't think they expected Bolden to attack like that, especially from the defensive position.
And that's what I was alluding to earlier in the game. My friend Tessa Bonham's done it a few times there, as I think she has the puck right there, but Bolden proved why she's so dangerous. She read the pass, intercepted, she was in the slot area, and if it wasn't for the blocker hand of Kessler, it's 1-0 Blades.
Perov dumped it in. Toronto with the change. Bonhomme out there now with Kohanchuk, Spooner, Megan Arts, and the captain, Brittany Smith. Kohanchuk with a lead pass up to Arts. A three-on-two opportunity. Arts backtracks. And her pass to Smith intercepted by Stack. And back they go the other way. Kelly Stack waiting for Buser. Back to Knight. And she fired it high and wide. Brittany Smith now winds up with it. And Tessa Bonhomme back the other way. Another potential three-on-two. Spooner. Bonhomme nearly went offside. Spooner's shot goes wide. Back and forth they go. Lawness to Dempsey. The pass went a bit too far for her. Megan Arts on an attempted hit there by Dempsey. She's slow to get up. It looked as though she went for the hit.
Left arm sore.
And her left arm is sore, but look at her. She's staying out there.
She can hardly hold on to the stick, actually, right now. She went down heavily. We mentioned there was a collision, and she's hurt now. And I'm going to have to say it's her left arm because she had one hand on the stick and her arm tucked into that vulnerable position. This is Bolden stripping the puck, getting a turnover, and getting a grade-A scoring opportunity. There have been two glorious chances for Boston.
Tough play there for Blake Bolden. She elected to go for the snapshot, and she was off balance. And you'd have to think if she had another second, she could have gotten a bit more accuracy on it. Intercepted by Chevrolet. And Ott saw it all the way, gloves it, and hangs on with 9:53 remaining in the second.
Yeah, that was just a routine stop for Ott, who has just been outstanding. Kessler at the other end, no slouch yourself, as we saw a couple of point-blank opportunities. The difference in this one, Kelly Stack on the doorstep as we have another TV timeout here at the Markham Centennial Arena. Capacity crowd, they're still filing in. And I love to see, yesterday I was watching dads coming in with two little girls with them to see. And these are the role models, these women on the ice here. They're here to get autographs. And perhaps one day, one of these young ladies, these little girls that are in the crowd, will be the ones representing their countries at the Olympics. The Golden Mail, Manulife
Financial. So as we take a look at the stats so far in this game, or at least in this period, as of just a few minutes ago, the Blades had a 3-2 shot advantage in this period alone. 12-12, the shots right now. Of course, only one penalty for each team. You mentioned Kate Buser for body checking at 6:48 of the first, and Martine Garland, a hooking call at 11:14. And those are the only players to make their way onto the score sheet in this championship game.
But not in a good way.
Not in a good way at all.
No, you watch Buser when she went to the box, and the same thing with the Toronto Furies player as well. Any penalty you take is a chance for the other team to walk away with their name on the Clarkson Cup, because two power play goals were the difference in the game on Thursday, which was day two of the round robin, between these two clubs, a one-goal game. So keeping your nose clean, if you will, with the old expression, is the order of the day. And they've been doing a good job. And the referees and the officials, they've been invisible because they've been doing their job wonderfully. Credit to them.
And a great thing to note as well, or an interesting thing to note about this Toronto power play, during the season against Boston, there was only one game in which Toronto did not score a power play goal, and that was their final matchup just a week ago, March 16th, in Boston, a 4-3 victory for the Blades. These teams matched up pretty closely during the season as well. A 4-2 advantage for Boston. Toronto was 2-2, 1-1, an overtime and a shootout loss. Garland with a slap shot went just wide of the net. It bounced off the end boards, and Cook was the first one to get to it for Boston. Bolden up to Pickett. Pickett will dump it into the zone along the boards and behind the Toronto net. Changes for the Blades here. And now Toronto with some speed. Beezer went offside as Kerry Matamo was looking for a rush to start there against the Blades.
Yeah, that was a case there where they had a bit of a turnover. Boston in the midst of a line change there. It was chipped out off the glass inside the Toronto Fury zone, down through center, picked up by a Toronto player. They were just dumping it out. Boston, as we said, in the midst of getting some fresh legs on the ice. And quickly in on the right side there was Beezer in an offside position as Holly Carey Madwell just cutting to the left a little bit there at the blue line, and then they had words as they went by. But you got to imagine that despite everything the coaches tell you, you got to be a little nervous, and it's probably less nervous now as the game goes on. But off the top, these women must be awfully nervous knowing what's on the line in this contest.
and playing in front of this extremely attentive crowd. And if you get a chance, folks, look at the mass of people just behind Brittany Ott in that Boston net, all standing and watching this game as Bucer heads in with speed. The shot went just wide of the net. Kessler didn't have to touch that one, and she was lucky. So it would have been a tough save. Hillary Knight now in front, stopped by Kessler. She tipped it up and over the net. Kelly Stack battling with Kohanchuk, handled now by Knight. Taberna with the shot, gloved by Kessler through a crowd. With 8:20 remaining in the second, it's still a scoreless game.
And a great crowd on hand, showing their appreciations for both these clubs. They've got the mascot here down below. There's what you were talking about. This is the home of the Markham Waxers. They used to be a team in the Ontario Junior Hockey League. Ron Wilson played for them. The commissioner of the Canadian Hockey League, ex-commissioner of the Canadian Hockey League, Dave Branch, played here. Jerome Dupont, who played for the Chicago Blackhawks. Adam Oates, Steve Thomas. Ron Wilson played here as well. There's quite a list of famous alumni who have played inside this arena. And actually, Jerome Dupont, the former NHLer and now a current coach in the OJHL, was here a little earlier saying hello to one of our crew members and me.
For those of you in the States watching, of course, the city of Markham is a suburb just northeast of Toronto, the capital city of Ontario.
Different mayor, though, right? Can we say that?
I think it's safe to say that the mayor of Markham is actually watching this game and may have actually shown up. And I won't dive into that issue any further. Pick up Robin Doolittle's book, Crazy Town, available in various bookstores and online as Brittany Ott handles it behind the net and leaves it for Casey Bellamy. Left in the neutral zone, and Cook picks it up. Tried to speed into the zone, but now Toronto controls it. It's Jessica Vella. Vella battling with Dostal. Now winds up with it. A dangerous pass. Went off of Christy Zamora, and behind the net, Zamora still battling with the Blades defenders. That was Whitney Naslund. Naslund carries it up for Boston. Naslund still with it. Vella watching her closely. Cycles to Cook. Now back to the line. Dostal with the shot, intentionally wide, it looked like. And now it's picked up by the Furies and carried out by Lexi Hoffmeyer. She'll dump it into the Boston zone and head off for a change. Back out there is Prevost and Chevry for Toronto, along with Bonhomme and Brittany Smith. That top defensive pairing. Baldwin now out there with that line of Chevry and Prevost, and an offside call against the Blades. And they're wondering, Kate Bucer over there to talk to the ref. She wasn't happy.
Well, what happened there was they were trying to play the puck down the near side boards. Knight recognized it, grabbed it, started to head back inside the zone. But the bench door is just inside the blue line. As Bucer stepped on, it was a close call at the blue line. The official said it's offside. You're not going to win those battles if you argue with them.
Blake Bolden now carries it into the Toronto zone. She centered it, and Knight couldn't get a stick on it. Taberna still controls it for Boston. 6:15 left in the second period. 0-0 the score in the 2014 Clarkson Cup Championship game presented by Scotiabank. My name's Asher Roth, here with Anthony Regan and Sarah Wright on the Streaming Sports Network website. And, of course, CWHL.ca. Pleasure to have you with us wherever you're watching, anywhere around the world.
And they are, too.
And they
the
are.
Part.
It's unbelievable.
Yeah, the support has been incredible.
Kelly Stack in the corner behind the Toronto net. Leaves it for Knight. Ever dangerous with that puck. A behind-the-back centering pass. And if Kelly Stack had found that one, it very easily could have been a scoring play.
Everybody in the crowd saw that pass. The players on the ice didn't recognize the ones. Anyway, in front of the net, the three. One black sweater, two white.
They're dead on there. It didn't even seem like the crowd reacted very strongly. It could be because it's relatively Toronto-centric. Now a centering pass by Dempsey, no one there. Bolden there, left it for who she thought was her own defender, but instead Chevry picked it up. Some sloppy passing on both sides here as Koizumi winds up with it, and a two-on-two chance. Now Boston has four players in the zone. Lonis' shot was blocked. Another opportunity, now she holds it and leaves it for Koizumi. Left it for Taverna. That pass went wide, and Wolfeiler had to handle it. Dumps it behind the net, another centering attempt picked up by Shannon Molson. Molson battles behind the net with Dempsey. Koizumi brings it out front, turns to her forehand, leaves it. It's tipped up and over the net. Kessler, I don't think she saw that one. A perfect screen by the Blades forward there. Prevo up to Chevry, nearly turned over, but Prevo backtracks and leaves it for Brittany Smith in her own zone by the near faceoff circle, and Smith will lob it up, and Prevo got her stick on that one inside the blue line. Surprise, no call on that play for an offside, but instead a penalty is coming here to the Blades as Baldwin got knocked down in the far corner behind the Boston net, and it looks like it's going to be Alyssa Wolfeiler getting the call for the Blades.
Well, Jillian Dempsey, the rookie, the captain Smith for the Toronto Furies there didn't really have a lot going on. So what she did was she lifted the puck high in the air. Another TV timeout, just by the way, in case you're wondering. So it was lifted. It nearly hit the uprights, the supports here in the Markham Arena. It didn't. It landed just inside the zone. The puck was played in the air, as you said, but it wasn't a high stick. It was only about waist high. So the puck was tipped down, went into the corner. One of the Toronto players went down, and into the box goes Wolfeiler, who has been having a great game herself. I have come up with a nickname for Ms. Bolden. I'm going to call her Blake Golden Bolden. And look at that. We have two RCMP and the Chevy mascot, if you will, here. Making the kids just love the mascots. There's a giant Golden Lab here as well. Look at that. And the people in the States are saying, that is a perfect example of Canadiana right there, isn't it?
That's really too neat. And the Toronto government is going to, or excuse me, the Canadian government will have to watch out. We might have a new prospective Canadian ambassador to the United States, or rather an American ambassador to Canada. That Blades mascot, the Chevy safety mascot.
And there's a giant helmet out here in the Markham Arena as you make your way inside. And I do mean giant. It can fit at least four people in, because four members of the SSN crew got inside the helmet last night posing for pictures. One of them bumped her head on the way out and said, "You hurt yourself with a helmet on? That big?"
Oh, boy. A great argument for, I'm sure, Craig McTavish and everybody else of that old school group that don't believe in helmets, as Smith took a point shot there. It was tipped just wide by Christy Zamora. Kohanchuk along the backboards to Caroline Prevo, intercepted by Bellamy, who then stood up. Prevo behind the net. Spooner playing the point. They work the umbrella across to Kohanchuk to Brittany Smith. She winds and fires, and Bucer tipped it wide. Kohanchuk winds up back with it. 30 seconds into this power play for the Toronto Furies. They're 0-for-1 so far. Quick pass to the front of the net by Prevo. They battle for it. Perfect defensive coverage by Bucer and Bolden in front of the Boston net. A flip attempt to clear it by Brittany Smith, who fired it at the net, and Zamora couldn't get a stick on it for the tip. Dump behind the net by Kohanchuk as she'll go off for a change and replaced by Tessa Bonhomme. And now Smith will come off in favor of Bonello, and Bonhomme couldn't keep it in. And now Hillary Knight looking for some help. She'll backtrack and kill some valuable time on this power play. 50 seconds remaining in it, 3 minutes remaining in the second period. Toronto 0, Boston 0.
The best opportunity right there was a shot off the point in the top of the umbrella, as you said, but Bucer dropped to one knee and took that and blocked it, and that's a gutsy thing to do. We've seen two injuries, both of them to Toronto players blocking shots, but that's been the order of the day here, as these women know what's on the line. They're going to sacrifice body and soul to win that Clarkson Cup.
So Chevry with the quick shot there, easily covered up by Brittany Ott. And so 30 seconds remaining on this power play. Bonhomme throws it at the net. Nice block there by Koizumi. Nearly created an odd woman rush. And it's knocked to center ice, handled by Bonello. And a slap shot all the way down the ice by Maggie Taverna. Kills even more time.
Koizumi, the assistant coach at Yale, and she's often flying or driving all the way to Boston to take part in the practices and the games, etc. And boy, she logs in a lot of travel time.
Bonhomme with a shot was tipped wide by Brittany Ott. She got her pad on it just at the last minute. Team's back at full strength here as Wolfeiler's out of the box, and she jumps right back into the play to the line. Is Bolden to Bonhomme. Left it in front for Chevry. She tipped it back to the point for Bolden. And Cook, Kelly Cook, took a chance there, trying to create the rush going the other way. And nearly took herself out of the play, as we're going to have a whistle here with 1:48 left in the second.
Any surprise to you, Asher Roth, that this is a 0-0 game as we're going into the final 2 minutes, under the final 2 minutes here in the middle frame of what have been very close contests all throughout the regular season? Boston, the only team that was able to solve the Montreal Stars in regulation. They did that in the first game, in their first matchup, and the very last one. Montreal got the four games in between. But a lot of one-goal games in this league.
Of course, not to mention the opening game of this tournament, a close 1-0 victory and a shutout by Brittany Ott.
And that goal went off of, Buser got the goal, but it went off of Julie Chu's body by accident back at the net. She even swiped at it knowing that it went off her, couldn't negate it from going past her netminder.
Minute 25 left to go in this third period. Megan Arts battles Taverna behind the Boston net, or rather in the near corner behind the Boston net. Taverna comes free with it, knocks it along the boards, a nice pass, and Wolfeiler now gives chase along with Kohanchuk. Garland did a great job getting back for Toronto and leaving Boston no room for a rush. Minute left in the third period. Kohanchuk with a nice move, and she fired it just off, I believe, the crossbar, but Ott might have gotten a piece of it. She had the right idea, finding the hole. Kelly Stack looking for Knight in front of the net. Brittany Smith went down for the block, didn't get it, but luckily Boston couldn't get their stick on that pass. And Toronto will go offside as Katie Wilson was just a half stride ahead of Holly Carey-Matamo.
There's been a couple of opportunities which have looked dangerous, and two of them are point blank for the Blades as we take a look at Knight and what a tremendous, tremendous athlete she is, and her teammates, of course, in Boston. This last one, though, belongs to Kohanchuk coming down the left wing side. She shoots tight, blocker side upstairs, and it looks like Ott, as she has done time after time, got a piece of this one, but as you say, nearly hit the crossbar and post where they meet.
Ott leaves it for Casey Bellamy behind the net. Koizumi now brings it into the Toronto zone looking for help. Koizumi holds, fires, went wide. Brittany Smith got a stick on it and hauled down behind the net was Jill Dempsey, who you may recall hurt her left arm a few minutes ago. Looks like she's not suffering any ill effects that are clear to us. 10 seconds remaining in the period. One more chance, and Kessler with a nice glove save on Jill Dempsey.
Well, Dempsey went heavily into the end boards, and as you say, she is not getting a lot of love from Toronto in this game. She is in two calls. She went off. She collided. She had a collision with another player back in the first period, and I kept watching her on the bench. I had my eye on the play and one eye on the bench to see if the rookie of the year was going to be okay. She gets up. She was hurt a little earlier as well in another collision. And there she went heavily into the end board, so not a lot of love for the ROI, the rookie of the year.
One more chance there in front of Christina Kessler, and it looked as though Kate Buser accidentally knocked the net off. So a whistle here with 2.6 seconds remaining in the second period. We're going to have one more face-off. Bellamy will try for the slap shot. Buser looked as though she accidentally blocked it. So how about this, Anthony Regan? Toronto 0, Boston 0 after two periods of play. And just what a period.
Just an incredible back and forth affair. One power play opportunity, and it was Alyssa Wolfeiler who took a hooking call at the 15:48 mark. But again, the penalty kill of the Boston Blades, and they are sacrificing so well. This has been an outstanding game, and could you ask anything more of the Clarkson Cup final game between two clubs that have played so well in the round robin portion? The two terrific teams, and it's 0-0 heading into the third period. Boy, we had overtime in the game in Toronto-Montreal yesterday. One wonders what the future of the final, in regulation time anyway, 20 minutes, hold for us.
Well, folks, certainly cannot afford to go anywhere. Stick around for the intermission. We'll have lots of fun conversation for you discussing this game, the previous games of the tournament, all sorts of action throughout this great Clarkson Cup this season. But for right now, we're going to send it down to Sarah Wright, who has an Olympic gold medalist with her. That's Tara Watchorn, the former Calgary Inferno defenseman.
Thank you, gentlemen. I am here with Tara. Now, Tara, this isn't Sochi, but what do you think about the atmosphere in Markham?
It's amazing. And I was talking to Brenda, the commissioner, earlier, and she was so intense on wanting to get a good crowd here today, and I think she did just that. And there's a lot of people working hard to make women's hockey grow, and this is a good symbol that it is, and it's a really cool atmosphere here today.
Now, Calgary Inferno not in this final game, but a lot of your teammates and opponents from Sochi are here. Is there any jealousy watching them? Do you wish you were playing? Any regrets?
I do miss it a little bit. It was a long 9 months preparing for the Olympics, and it's nice to rest. But, I mean, anytime you watch hockey, you want to get out there. So it's cool watching them, though.
And there's a lot of young girls here. The Tim Hortons were, the Timbits were skating around all week. Does it get you really excited to know that 10, 15, 20 years from now, there's going to be a lot more Tara Watcherns in the world?
That's been the best part about coming back from the Olympics and seeing all the kids. They're so excited, and you get reactions from both sides of the spectrum, whether they care about the medal or they don't. But, no, it's really cool, and having the opportunity to inspire young girls and boys, it's amazing. And the fact that they come out here and like to watch us play, it's hopefully fingers crossed for them.
You mentioned your medal. It's here. I felt it. It's very heavy. Interesting thing, talking to Kevin Dedeen, coach, they don't actually give coaches a gold medal, and he told me he was going to actually ask to borrow yours. Would you let him take your medal for, say, a day?
Definitely. He did so much for us. I mean, anything I could, if you wanted to borrow it, that's, he can have it.
That's so nice of you. Watching this game so far, I know you're having fun up in the lounge, but who do you think is going to take this one?
It's tough for me because, I mean, I went to Boston University. I love the city, but I'm going to have to stick with my Canadian friends on this one, and I think they're going to pull through.
What do you think of Natalie Spooner's game so far?
She's a great player. I've actually grown up playing with her since I went to women's hockey, and we played at Durham West, and she is just her speed, her power, and then you add hands on top of it. She's tough to defend.
And I've got to interview a lot of your teammates, and they are awesome. They're such nice girls. How much do you enjoy hanging out with the Inferno, like off-season, during the season?
When I moved to Calgary, it's a tough transition. I'm moving away from home and don't really know a lot of people, but when I met that team 2 years ago, it's just been instant friendships, and they're a great group of girls, and I'm so happy that they made it to the Clarkson Cup this year, and it's been nice to touch base with them again and hang out.
Thanks so much for joining me. Go back to your lounge. All right, guys, you can take it back.
After two periods of play, a scoreless game, and really all that you could ask for in a championship game, a low-scoring, great defensive game. Not a lot of shots in that second period, just six all for each side. Anthony, we got a question from one of our tweeters, I'll mention her later on, asking us what she thinks, or what we think each team has to do to get a goal on the board.
Just the impossible. Solve tremendous netminders. No, find a way to get... a two-on-one rush. There's going to have to be a breakdown. It's not going to be a pretty goal. It's not going to be one of these buttes that goes in, because both these netminders, Kessler and Ott, respectively, are tremendous, and they're outstanding. They do their job so well. So it's not going to be a beautiful goal. It's going to be something dirty. It'll be a redirect through, off a skate or something, a bit of a surprise goal, if you will. That's what I'm thinking. And you're going to have to watch out for the back end. We have Blake Bolden, who can get the job done. Tessa Bonhomme, who can get it done as well. Both of them are fearless when it comes to leaving the defensive posture back at the blue line and getting in on the rush and throwing in that extra person in there. You're expecting three forwards in, but when you have a defender in as well, that can also open up. It's one of those risk-reward kind of things. Gives you a chance to maybe get something in on the attack, but then you got to watch out. You have to make sure that your wingers are aware. If you're gonna take off from that defensive posture and walk down the wall, pinch, come alive, or try and be a backdoor option, etc., you make sure one of your forwards is recognizing, oh, we've left a door open behind us. I better go back there and make sure nobody's sneaking back down. It's going to be an odd man rush coming down the ice, I think, and you're going to have to, again, get maybe a dirty goal past these two outstanding netminders.
That was Allie at What's in a... We'll answer that on another time, maybe on our... On our cooking show that we'll host in a couple of years.
Stay tuned.
Spicy herb. It's delicious. Anyway, a great game in this one. Let's quickly discuss. We talked about the Calgary Inferno during the first intermission.
Okay.
The Montreal Stars,
You've
really got to give them a little bit of credit, despite the fact that they did not make it to this final game. A huge regular season for them, 19-2-2. Things just didn't quite click for them in this tournament.
And it was the opening game that I think caused them the most problems. It was Boston-Montreal, a classic original six. Far back as the NHL goes, anyway, sort of realignment or a game, a matchup between the two clubs. and they couldn't solve each other in that one either. It ended up being, again, another lousy goal that got past Héron in net for Montreal. So that's what I'm saying. This one will be down to that. I wouldn't be surprised if we go to extra time in this one as well, because both teams aren't giving an inch. There's been more opportunities, or at least grade-A scoring chances, that have been afforded. Boston, Stack had one, and Bolden had the other one, where she turned the puck over. She stripped it, pardon me, intercepted a pass, walked up the middle of the ice, fired a snapshot. Now, you were saying if she had a second or two longer, she might have had a better shot. But I think what she was trying to do is catch Kessler off guard, because if you shoot on the fly while you're skating, it's a bit of a natural ability that not every player has. Bolden can do it. She comes walking in. She snaps the puck quickly. And sometimes when goalies are shifting and watching what you're going to do, you can catch them in motion, kind of. And in this particular instance, pardon me, Kessler was aware of this and used the blocker just to steer it wide of the net. So very good opportunities at either end of the ice there for Boston. One in the first period for Kelly Stack, when she walked out, Kessler made a stop with her glove hand. The second one was Bolden, where she created the turnover, walked in the middle, fired a snapshot. Kessler got a piece and turned it wide.
Yeah, Bolden certainly had the right idea on that play. And as you said, kind of leaning into her right leg and getting away that scoring chance. Now, Anthony, it's been such a tight defensive game so far. Mm-hmm. Few opportunities, at least, that have been kept track of on the score sheet. Mm-hmm. Only six shots apiece in that period, and yet there was that 1 or 2 minute span where we saw some crazy rushes going back and forth. Do you think that that was just a momentary lapse between the two teams, or are we maybe going to see more of that in the third period?
Oh boy, that's a great question, Asher, because as you know, they both teams started out tentatively, and as you say, the game started to open up a little bit, and they start going back and forth either way. I don't think you're going to sit back and try and hold on to a nothing-nothing tie through 20 more minutes of hockey and try and force it to overtime, but I do have a feeling that the next goal is going to win, so whoever manages to solve the opposition's netminder probably, and that's not probably is going to come away with the win in the next 20 minutes, because it's been so tight back and forth. There's been opportunities, limited though, and let's face it, there Dempsey's taking a rough ride, but she just shakes herself off, gets up off the ice. She went heavily into the boards, fell down a couple of times. One of them, she came down holding her stick in one hand and sort of taking care of her arm, if you will. She had it bent awkwardly, and I thought, oh my goodness gracious, what a blow that would be to Boston to have Dempsey and her never quit compete level out of the game. But again, she's gone down a few times, she's been banged up and bruised, but she's back and looking for more. Who do you think's going to solve the netminders for these teams?
Now we got to be careful on this, because Nico,
okay,
so this is going to be a high pressure pick. Gonna have to be really easy to say this is going to be a high pressure pick Gonna have to be really easy to say Spooner for Toronto.
Yeah.
But let's go with a wild card. Easy to say Spooner for Toronto.
Yeah.
But let's go with a wild card play. I'm gonna say Holly Carey Matamo, just based on that great goal that she had against Boston during the round robin. It's gonna take some creativity, as you've said, and it will probably, we've seen the raw skill that she has, and if not her, probably Janelle Kohanchuk. So we saw her playing some sweet dangles against the Boston defense, nearly scoring in that first period. How about you? What would you say for Boston?
For Boston, for me, I'm going to say somebody on the back end like Bolden, who said isn't afraid, because she's got tremendous foot speed, to join the rush or get in on when the puck's alive in the offensive zone. She'll just leave that defensive posture and race down and try and help out. She's an option. She's got an excellent shot, a really hard shot, and I think it was going to be two defenders. I was going to pick one for Toronto, Bonhomme, and one for, of course, Boston and Bolden. So I'm thinking it's going to be the D who factor in here. It may just be an assist on a tipped goal or whatever, but I do have a feeling they both looked really comfortable engaging offensively.
Just a fantastic tournament so far that we have witnessed just from day one. Five of the six round-robin games, only decided by one goal. The only one that wasn't was the game that didn't have any implications for either team involved. Boston last night mostly just playing to practice for this one. And what an offensive attack that they had against the Calgary Inferno. We've already discussed the potential mismatch in that situation that Coach Didgett Murphy talked about. The Toronto Furies have had nothing but close games. They haven't done a ton of scoring, and like you've said, if Boston were to find a way to get on the board, it's going to certainly be a challenge for Toronto to be able to match any sort of offense that Boston throws at them.
So it's just a real even game, though, and you can't ask for more because there's nothing worse than getting to the final game and it's 8-0 for one team where the goals just start going in and it comes off the rails for one of the clubs. I don't think anybody has any interest in that one. And this is one of those games where the fans are in it right to the end. You have a tendency to lose people where it's, you know, it's 5-0. It's like, well, let's see what else is happening in the world, especially sitting here in the seats. They're just not as interested when it gets that way. This is down to the final 20 minutes in regulation, and it's going to be anybody's game.
So once again, we're going to summarize a little bit between the Toronto Furies and the Boston Blades. The shots after that second period, 6-6, only one penalty called against Boston. It was Alyssa Wolfiler taking the one penalty. But for right now, Anthony, we're going to send it down to Sarah Wright, who has a guest down in the media room.
Thanks, Asher. I'm here with Jeff Fredericks, spokesperson for the league. Jeff, it's been a great week so far. I'm honored to be a part of this. What motivated you to get this to the great event that it is?
Well, I think this is the best women's hockey on the planet that we're witnessing here this week. And I think really when we look at how many fans have expressed interest in women's hockey, they're certainly here today. We couldn't be more thrilled. We think, you know, this league is really an amazing league, and these women are fantastic athletes, and we're just thrilled to be here.
Now, there's a lot of volunteers going into this. Did you have any problems getting enough people to come and put in their time?
No, you know, there's a lot of passionate hockey fans out there, and myself included. That's really how I got involved. So you look around, there's a lot of folks that love this game and want to help out, and it's really the volunteers that are making this league possible, in my opinion.
Is there anything you would change going forward, maybe for next year's Clarkson Cup, anything like that?
Well, it's a work in progress as far as, you know, promoting this league. There's lots of things that we can continue to improve on in terms of getting the word out. But I think, you know, just encouraging this community to get out and enjoy this excellent brand of hockey is really what we need to do.
Well, you convinced me this week. So looking back over the last 4 days, 5 days, what are you going to remember the most?
I got to meet a lot of these players and have conversations with them, and they are amazing women. They're highly educated, they're extremely passionate, and I think they are excellent role models for all women and frankly, everyone. They're just great, great people, so that's been my highlight.
Perfect. Thanks so much, Jeff. Gentlemen, you can take it back.
Over the world, if you keeping a good eye on this, and you're right. Is it called the Twitterverse?
Twitterverse is one way to put it. It's the Twitter.
athletes of this caliber perform, man, is it worth every penny to me.
And it really creates rivalries when you face the same teams six times in a season. 12 home games on the schedule for each team. And once again, if you can come out and support your local team, folks, no matter where you're listening from, Brampton, Toronto, Calgary, Boston, or Montreal, that lists them off, I believe.
That is.
And just come out to the game, support these great women hockey players. They really play hard, and if you're new to this tournament, it's such a treat for us to cover it, such a treat for us to watch. It's a pleasure to bring you this coverage. Just want to go back to Twitter quickly and thank some of our followers for the positive feedback. Just want to thank @CelesteOpsimath for complimenting my head nodding ability. That is definitely a difficult skill. Like to thank you for that one. A little bit of a joke there. And some pretty great feedback just on referring to the advantages, or, you know, the rushes, I guess I should say, the lopsided rushes as odd woman rushes as opposed to odd man rushes. We apologize, of course, as well, if we do use terms that are universal to the men's game, or rather that are more normally used in the men's game. Of course, you know, watching hockey, unfortunately, the women's game hasn't been as prominent for at least the majority of our lives. Anthony, you could probably say the majority of the hockey that we've watched throughout our lives and we've watched on television anyway has been for the men's game, and so these terms become ingrained in our heads. And you heard it as well before the game with the national anthem, the gender-neutral lyrics to it.
All of us command.
All of us command. It really brings out, it's the topic of changing the conversation, changing the terminology, and really giving credit to these women hockey players. And, you know, it really challenges the stigmas that people have about the women's game, thinking that there isn't as much hitting, thinking that there isn't as much speed. It's so great to watch. This is the highest level, and it's just a pleasure to be able to take it in. We thank everybody for watching.
That's one of the things we consciously try to do as when we're on air, talking about women's hockey. I don't use the term power play opportunity, extra man on the ice. I say extra attacker, just to try and be careful about that, my friend.
Brenda Andrus, the commissioner for another great Clarkson Cup here in the city of Markham. Thank you. And thank you to all of our Olympians, to all of the players for a great week of hockey. And now it's my pleasure to make a special presentation on behalf of the city of Markham. Whereas Jillian Apps, who grew up in Unionville, Ontario, has represented our city and our country with tremendous pride and distinction as a member of the Canadian Women's National Ice Hockey Team. And whereas Jillian is a three-time Olympic gold medal champion, Sochi 2014, Vancouver 2010, Turin 2006, and an eight-time medalist at the IIHF Women's World Championships, winning gold medals in 2004, 2007, 2012, and silver medals in 2005, 2008, 2009, 2011, and 2013. And whereas Jillian has been a contributor and participant in bringing the Canadian Women's Hockey League Clarkson Cup Championship to the city of Markham in 2013 and 14, and where Jillian's athletic excellence, sportsmanship, and outstanding community spirit has been a positive role model for women's hockey and for youth in our city and around the world, I therefore, as the mayor of Markham and on behalf of the city of Markham, do hereby proclaim March 22nd as Jillian App Day in the city of Markham. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Scarpitti. Once again, the Lucky Chuck-a-Puck winner is number 197. Congratulations, Deegan Schinner. Please come to the penalty box to pick up your prize.
All right. Two teams, one Clarkson Cup, one period remaining. Only one team will emerge the champion. That is generally how sports works. Toronto and Boston scoreless through two periods of play. Asher Roth, Anthony Regan, Sarah Wright over on the in the media room doing the interviews as the third period is underway and Blake Bolden handles it for the Boston Blades. Bolden up to Kelly Stack, bouncing puck, corralled by Knight. Her shot went right off Brittany Smith's skate. Spooner tried to clear it out, but Bellamy intercepted it at the point. Stack behind the net now. They battle, Knight there to help out. Brittany Smith almost has her in a lock there. As you mentioned, Anthony, the ref's really letting the teams play for the most part. Only three penalties so far in this game. Easily the least penalized game of the tournament so far. Hillary Knight with a chance. Back to Bolden. Knight tried to make the next pass. Buser gets hauled down by Tessa Benum, who fires the puck with frustration along the boards.
Interference.
And an interference call coming to Tessa Benum,
which I'm kind of surprised at. Let's take a look at this replay again. It looked to me as it was a dangerous turnover right at their the blue line there for Toronto. It looked like Buser at the side of the net. The pass came to her. It looked like the stick was lifted. However, it's an interference call nonetheless. Second opportunity to score with the extra attacker.
So watch out for the short, quick passing for the Boston Blades. They've been so effective and looked so great at it just one night ago. Cardella back to the line. Wolfweiler nearly had her pocket picked by Prevo. She maintains possession to the side of the net. A nice save by Kessler, and she kicked it just wide of the Boston attack, and it's knocked down the ice by Toronto. 30 seconds gone in this power play.
Terribly sorry. Kazumia looked like she was going to pass across to Dempsey, and instead it looked like she tried to stuff it in the short side and bank it in off of Kessler.
Carried into the zone, pass back to Cardella. It was Wolfweiler. Koizumi let the puck go past her, and now Bonello with a chance to clear it. She decides to hang on to it. A long pass up to Spooner, nearly sprung her on a quick break. Spooner finishes her check on Cardella. A clean hit, making sure her back was to the boards. And it's dumped all the way down the ice, handled by Blake Bolden. The crowd has gone dead silent in anticipation of perhaps a goal or two in this game. Carried into the zone, Kelly Stack looking for someone in front. Left it behind the net. Stack battling Garland, Buser, now Knight looking for help. Back to the line, Casey Bellamy to Bolden. Bolden across to Knight. Great defense there by Megan Arts, making it difficult for Knight to keep her positioning. Bolden with the shot. She was looking for a tip in front, and it went through about four skaters' sticks and went wide. Hillary Knight in the back corner. Along the boards to Bolden. Stack at the point. Works out in front of Megan Arts. Cross to the side. Hillary Knight, the centering pass, and Pucer couldn't get a stick on it. And it's dumped out down the ice. The power play coming to a close. 3 seconds remaining in Bonhomme's infraction, and now she'll head out right in front of where Hillary Knight was standing, waiting for the lead pass, and looked as though Kate Buser might have blown a tire there. She's all right as she went skates first into the corner. Bonello with the slap shot. Huge rebound and a huge save by Ott. Kohanchuk had a huge opportunity and couldn't get it past Brittany Ott. Bolden backtracking. Kohanchuk now handles it still with speed, trying to catch Boston off guard. Pickett nearly picked it off. No pun intended there. As Vela gets knocked down by Koizumi. Back and forth they go. Handled now by Boston, brought in. And Koizumi, it was Taverna, dumping it into the Toronto zone where Molson tries to make a lead pass to Katie Wilson. Instead, Boston winds up with it in the neutral zone. It's going to be, I believe, a hand pass.
Jumped up and hit a player on the bench, hit them in the hand. That's what I was trying to gesture to you. Earlier, though, Buser parked at the back door, far side from our vantage point here. As we take a look here, the glorious opportunity. How did they tie her up at the last second there? And it looked like Ott came across. Just an incredible stop there. Earlier, it was Spooner who took away Buser's tap-home goal at the back door in the dying seconds of that power play opportunity. So both teams are 0 for 2 with the extra attacker.
Brittany Ott probably allowing the most blatant rebound of the tournament on that scoring chance by Kohanchuk, and she lucked out that Kohanchuk couldn't get a clean shot. Koizumi winds and fires, and Kessler corrals it and hangs on.
We were talking earlier, somebody tweeted us that Ott had made 72 saves. It was in her last game of her career with the Black Bears, and it was one to remember. She was competing against nationally ranked Boston College, the Eagles. She recorded an astounding 72 saves, but it was in an overtime loss. 72 saves. Unreal.
Kohanchuk carries it through the neutral zone into the Boston zone. Her shot tipped up and out of play by Blake Bolden.
And earlier, while we were in the second intermission there, Mayor of Markham, Frank Scarpitti, came out and declared that March 22nd will be Jillian Apps Day in the city of Markham. She grew up in Unionville, which is moments down the road here along Highway 7, very close to the city of Markham indeed. And Jillian won a number of gold medals, of course, for Team Canada.
Great recognition for her. Great to see Mayor Scarpitti at the event supporting this great event for the second consecutive year. That was Stack headed towards the net for the Blades. Brittany Smith picked it up, and she'll try to dump it out along the boards, but instead it's intercepted by Dostal. Hillary Knight with speed. Look at her go. She fired it at the net, and Buser couldn't get a stick on it. Now behind the net, a centering attempt by the Blades. and it's dumped. Oh, it hit the catwalk above the rink, and so it's whistled down with just over 5 minutes into this third period.
Ever seen a cat up there?
I haven't today.
No, not today. Usually they're all over the place. No, yeah, it did hit the girder as well. Boy, another close call there, and the crowd was oohing and aahing there at the other end of the ice as a player got taken down. And Kohanchuk, in her own zone there, got knocked down, and there was two black sweaters there. She still dove and chipped the puck to her defender. They were able to clear the zone because of that.
Once again, folks, follow us and interact with us on Twitter. At the Asher Roth is my handle, at Little Antony R. That's LittleAntnyR is Anthony Regan, my partner's Twitter handle, and our reporter Sarah Wright's Twitter handle, at Sarah Wright S3.
We welcome the feedback and the comments, indeed. And people were saying, odd woman rush, that's interesting. But there are women out there playing, and I'd like to sort of use gender-neutral terms, or, you know, in this particular game, women-specific terms.
Well, it's certainly great to see as Bonello was just a little bit offside, as you could see. Christy Zamora was trying so hard to get herself back onside that she ended up tripping and sliding towards the Clarkson Cup emblem at center ice.
Michelle Bonello right there on the screen there. Nice close-up of the right side defender. She's out there with Shannon Molson.
Jill Dempsey leads the rush for the Boston Blades. No one was in front of her to be able to get the pass, though. Bonello has been so tight defensively in this game. Huge reason why Boston hasn't been able to get on the board yet. Baldin there helping out Bonello. Now Bonello winds up with it, knocks it off the boards, but is intercepted by Bolden. Winds up in the near corner in the Toronto zone. Shannon Molson with an errant pass, intercepted by Dempsey, carries it into the front of the net. Back to Bolden. Her shot tipped by Koizumi into the netting and out of play. It's going to be a TV timeout here.
I think Koizumi was trying to get in front and provide a screen. I'm not sure if he tipped or hit the body, nonetheless, of the diminutive forward, though. But as we said, she spends her time in Connecticut with the Yale team, where she's an assistant coach. And then on her own dime, she hustles all the way to practices all the time. She's logging the miles. And then sometimes she's flying from Connecticut to wherever the Boston Blades are playing. And that is dedication. And it's the same with the Toronto Furies when I talked with Summer West a few days ago about the commitment to the team and coming back. Natalie Spooner coming back from Sochi. A lot of people would say, you know what, I need a little time to decompress. And maybe she's, no, I've got to get back. When we have practice, there are 22 players out on the ice there taking part. And she said it's one of those teams where we are so tight and we're there for one another. That's one of the reasons why Spooner wanted to come back and compete. And yes, she wants to win the Clarkson Cup, but she's also coming back to be part of the team, which speaks to the character of these women playing hockey.
And how about this great gesture by the music staff here to play, and our Bostonian residents and fans that are listening to this game will appreciate Neil Diamond's Sweet Caroline playing over the PA. And it's funny, the Toronto fans in the crowd appear to be singing along. I don't know if they realize that this plays at every Boston Red Sox game. Nonetheless, a catchy song. Credit to Mr. Diamond.
You know
for
what?
Unleashing that hit.
My band's playing it now. We had to talk our singer into doing it. I said, it's not for you, it's for the crowd, because everybody loves it. Everybody knows that one part of the song. Ba, ba, ba.
Ba, ba, ba. Winds up back at the point. Should also mention, Anthony, you were called a hashtag cutie by one of our followers.
Thanks, Mom.
We both were.
I didn't know she was on Twitter or watching online, but appreciate it, Mom. I'll see you in a few days.
Casey Bellamy knocks it into the Toronto zone. Bonhomme gives chase behind the net. Bellamy gets help from Hillary Knight. Knight throws it at the net. It went off a skate. And Kessler had to be on top of that one. Brittany Smith lobs it into the zone. Tipped behind the net by Brittany Ott. And carried out by the speedy Blake Bolden. Look at her go. Bolden speeds into the zone and fires it just wide and around the Toronto defender, Martine Garland. Back to the point, Taverna with the shot. It was tipped by Buser. The rebound knocked out of harm's way by Holly Carey-Matimo. Now back they go was Katie Wilson. But Boston there to intercept it within their own zone. And dumped into the Toronto end by Dostal. Garland up to Katie Wilson. Wilson tips it into neutral ice. Taverna dumps it back in. 12 minutes and 10 seconds remaining in the third period. Nobody has lit the lamp so far, but somebody will have to before we go home today. Icing will be the call here against the Boston Blades in a 0-0 tie in the biggest game of the season for both of these teams.
As we get a look here at the replay, an opportunity as you see Bucer in front of the net being screened off there and a body falling at the side there as Knight was doing battle. So, man, they're pouring their hearts out there. They have yet to find the twine, though, with the puck. There's been opportunities, but both goaltenders and defensive core and everybody out there has been very responsible. Only four penalties, two aside. The officials have done an excellent job yet again.
And they have throughout the tournament as well. Great point there, Anthony, as it ends up behind the Boston net. Icing will be the call against Toronto with 11:38 remaining in the third.
Appreciating the feedback from people, too, who like the term extra attacker instead of extra man, etc. They said, you could do without the Miz, this, that, and the other. And I do apologize. I didn't have my roster in my hand, and I said Miz this and Miz that because I knew the last name, and I don't like calling people by just their last name. So I used Ms. Bolden once. It's the wrong thing to do, and I've learned from it. Thank you for that.
No, definitely the influence of the Globe and Mail, Canada's national newspaper, that always refers to people by Mr. and Ms. and Mrs. when they refer to somebody, as you said, Anthony, preferring not to use the term or just using someone's last name when describing them, as Kessler leaves it for Molson behind the Toronto net.
It just didn't feel right, just you saying Bolden. Oh, look at this.
Here we go. Spooner on a breakaway. Great defensive play by Casey Bellamy on her back and a centering pass. And Kohanchuk couldn't quite get her stick on it. 9 minutes into the third, still no score. Tessa Benham dumps it into the Boston zone, handled again by Bellamy. Spooner gives chase. Koizumi waits for it at the point, but Arts beats her there and leaves it for Spooner. She threw it at the net from an odd angle. Kohanchuk giving chase against Bolden. Now Bolden leaves it in the corner for Dempsey. And behind the net for Bellamy. Bellamy up to Lannis. Benham gives her a little check and a shot there by Prevo. Blocked. Brittany Smith, though, grabbed it with her hand, took the quick wrist shot, and then look at Spooner.
She was shoved in, though, shoved by Bolden.
No, see, from our angle, it initially looked as though she might have given Ought to shove, but it turns out she was trying to get out of the way of making contact with Brittany Ott, so credit to her there.
Bolden's the one who pushed Spooner in, by the way, but how about Bellamy on the two-on-one that was breaking? She dove and chopped the puck to the board. She put it in the best possible position to deny the Furies any sort of opportunity with the odd man rush, and it was a risky move, but it paid off well for Bellamy.
Likely saved the game there.
Exactly.
And didn't take a penalty on the play either.
Yeah.
Bonello leaves it for Bolden. And now Chevry gets some help from Prevo, and they head into the Boston zone. Chevry behind the net tried to center it. Now Prevo gets wrestled away from it by Kelly Stack. And now it's Alyssa Wolfiler with Hillary Knight. Behind the net, Chevry handles it for Toronto as Wolfiler left it there. Shannon Molson finds Chevry. Wholesale changes for Toronto. Chevry looking for a chance to get off. Now she does. And a chance now. Hauled down in front of the net. And a penalty coming to Boston.
Not
crowd
a penalty
might
shot.
Have been, yeah, the crowd was certainly looking for the penalty shot. But a tripping call is going to come here against Whitney Naslin.
Anytime you talk to a coach, they'll talk about the difference between a good and a bad penalty. That is a good penalty. You see the person to the right of the screen? That's the backdoor option right there, and that would have been picked out of the back of the net. So Naslin did the exact thing you do in a situation like that. You take the feet right out of the player coming in and nullify the option, because if you don't, it goes to the person who was turning, and you can see them creeping in from the right side of your screen. That was a definite goal against. There would have been nothing Ott could have done in that situation, barring a missed pass or whatever, but 90 times or 98 times out of 100, that's in the back of your net. So Naslin, an excellent penalty to take, in my estimation anyway.
So how about this? 10 minutes, 34 seconds gone in this third period. We're still scoreless, and you can feel the buzz in this arena. as the Toronto fans anticipate what could be one of their best opportunities of this game to light the lamp against this tightly knit Boston Blades defense as Ott slowly skates towards her crease.
Pardon me, my friend, TV timeout right now. That's why they're at the benches, of course, again, once again, for those watching, wondering why they're not getting back to the action. No timeouts are being called, but boy, anybody's game right here, and this is a huge opportunity. I thought the penalty kill earlier was a big one, but this is going to be the biggest one right now.
So here we go. On the ice for Toronto, Zamora, Brittany Smith, Janelle Kohanchuk, Natalie Spooner, and Caroline Prevo. Killing it off for Boston, Knight, Buser, Bolden. And I can't see who the fourth skater is. I believe it is number 22, Casey Bellamy, as it's knocked all the way down the ice. Left for Kohanchuk behind the Toronto net. She leaves it for Brittany Smith. Boston doing a perfect job trapping Toronto in their own zone, but now Koizumi has to backtrack as the Furies head the other way. Centered pass in front for Prevo. Couldn't get a clean shot away. Prevo along the boards. Christy Zamora helping out. A clearing attempt, and now Koizumi tips it all the way down the ice, and Kessler will leave it for Brittany Smith once again. Spooner is going to lead the rush for the Furies, getting some help from Chevry. Buser challenged her, still holds on to it. Megan Arts, kick save by Ott. As Arts got the shot away, and now it's dumped all the way down the ice by Ashley Cottrell. Corey Chevry missed that lead pass, and it's dumped back into the zone for Boston. 40 seconds remaining in this power play opportunity with Whitney Naslund in the box for the Blades.
Textbook kill right now, though, for Boston. They're keeping Toronto to the outside. They're tying up Spooner. They're not allowing much. Just one shot from Arts.
Corey Chevry with the shot from an odd angle. It looked like it hit the side of the net after deflecting off of Ott. Bolden, Benum calling for the pass. Still wide open. She wrists it, and it's stopped by Ott, and then she tipped it away with her stick. And it's dumped out and down the ice by Hillary Knight with 8 seconds remaining in the power play. Kessler comes right out and makes a lead pass to Tessa Benum. Benum sends in Wilson, but she couldn't get a shot away, and out of the box is Naslund. She'll head right back to the bench. Another penalty killed off for the Blades. Their third of this game. Behind the net for Boston, Maggie Taverna. They nearly turned it over to Beezer, but instead it's knocked down the ice slowly by Dempsey. And handled now by Martine Garland. Beezer gave a shove to Koizumi. Dempsey carries it into the Boston zone. Lawness with her, along with Koizumi. Toronto with the interception. It's Katie Wilson, and she'll head off for a change. Wholesale changes for the Furies. Koizumi backhands it behind the Furies' net. Handled by Hoffmeyer. Up to Arts. Now to Beezer.
Ooh.
And Beezer gets hit into the boards. And another penalty coming to the Blades with 6:36 remaining in the third. Another golden opportunity for the Furies.
It's going to be a penalty for checking. And that it's because of the proximity, I think, to the boards and the danger issue. When you're a couple of feet away and you get taken from behind, you could call it a boarding call. In this case, I believe it's going to be a body checking. Hey, how about this? I dug up on Ott in net for Boston there. She also in the offseason plays tennis and softball and did throughout college. Now, when you saw her knock away that rebound, and I saw her intercept the pass with her paddle in the first, softball, tennis come to mind.
What a fantastic point as Brittany Smith ends up with it at the blue line. Up to Prevo, now to Christy Zamora. Prevo battling with the Boston defender. They keep it in the zone. Brittany Smith, and it just ends up off the line. And Hillary Knight in on a breakaway. Hillary Knight stop. The rebound went over the net. Up over the crossbar. A huge save for Christina Kessler.
Listen on that save. This place went bananas. Save. This place went bananas.
Take another look. An errant pass by Kohanchuk, mishandled by Brittany Smith. And look at Hillary Knight go, the most dangerous player on the Blades. 4 goals yesterday. A huge glove save by Kessler. Can't hold on. But Knight fired the rebound over the net.
Kohanchuk's in the box there as she came down on the back check to try and help out after Knight and Kessler
tangled one-on-one. It went up and over behind, and then a little bit of cross-check to finish, I do believe, and here they come the other way.
Furious have to regret that, but back goes Prevo the other way with Bonhomme helping out. But Boston with, again, a perfect defensive coverage. Dempsey was right there to intercept the pass. Cross crease. Dempsey dumps it into the Furies zone. Kessler comes way out to play it up to Natalie Spooner, who is looking for a rush of her own. Tessa Bonhomme, 5 minutes, 40 seconds remaining in this third period. And a minute left of 4-on-4. It will be a 28-second power play for the Blades as soon as their player, Dostal, gets out of the box. Buser nearly intercepted a loose puck at center ice. Some nice defense there by Jessica Vella. She carries it into the Blades zone, watched closely by Bolden, and she cleanly wrestles her off of the puck. Back the other way goes Buser. Buser with 3 game-winning goals in the 3 round-robin games. Threw it at the net, but Molson tipped it up and into the netting with 5:07 left.
We asked Summer West, the head coach of the Furies, because we went to the Toronto side first. Their dressing room was just down below us. That's why Asher and I went there to speak with the head coach of Toronto, the coach of the year. Said, I said, how'd you sleep last night? And she said, oh, I slept like a baby last night, but she's wide awake right now on the bench. And actually, I was looking at Digit Murphy and Summer West, and both of them in this 4-on-4 back-and-forth affair. It's quite something indeed.
Some hilarious interaction from the tweeter that referred to us as hashtag cuties, I believe it was. Wanted to clarify when we thanked her for it by saying that unfortunately you and I, Anthony, do not qualify as her preference in that area.
We didn't make the roster, but look over there on the far side. Here comes the Clarkson Cup. It is right behind the benches. We're in a TV timeout now. There's 2 RCMP officers, Royal Canadian Mounted Police, in their dress uniforms, and they're making their way, and they're right now across the ice from us, right between the 2 benches. You'll see the Mounties, as they're called. I'm sure everybody around the world knows what that means, and they're standing there. There's the cup. I followed it in. You're following it home. Boy, this is going to be something. We're in for an exciting finish. 5:07 to go into third in regulation.
And 31 seconds remaining in the 4-on-4. Dostal and Kohanchuk in the box for their respective teams. Bellamy's lead pass up to Dempsey is going to go for an icing call as Dempsey was unable to corral that pass. And so the faceoff will be in the Blade zone. And I believe it will be Spooner taking the faceoff. She's been so effective on the faceoff in this tournament.
She's up against Koizumi.
And Koizumi wins it for the Blades. Bellamy tried to tip it along the boards. Great job there by Bonhomme keeping it in. Bellamy behind the net. Over to Dempsey. 5 seconds before Dostal will enter the box. Look out for, or exit the box, excuse me. Dempsey carries it in. The shot gloved easily by Kessler. Koizumi was right there waiting for a rebound. And you can see Kessler kind of point her stick at her as if to say, I can see you. Don't even try that.
Boy, it's nail-biting time here. There's 25 seconds to go in the power play, in which Kohanchuk took Knight and gave her a rough ride after Knight stole a puck, stripped, came down the ice, and had a scoring opportunity in which Kessler bested her.
Faceoff won by the Blades. Wolfeiler at the line. Back to Wolfeiler on the power play for another 18 seconds or so. Spooner with a great job wrestling that one loose, but kept in by Wolfeiler. Along the boards, intercepted by Wolfeiler on the clearing attempt by Bonhomme. Kohanchuk getting ready to exit the box in about 5 seconds from now. Back to the point. The shot, nice block by Brooke Beezer, and then she dropped her stick but picks it back up.
Ooh.
And a glove save by Kessler. It might have gone off her shoulder and out of play.
Yeah.
As we are now back to even strength for both sides.
Well, you got to wonder what's going through Brooke Beezer's mind. As you said, she dropped her stick after she blocked a puck. She nearly broke a body part yesterday blocking a shot in the game against Montreal. A good hard shot, and in this one as well, she's proven why Summer West trusts her. When the extra attacker's on Boston's side there, she threw herself in front of another puck. If you've ever blocked shots, folks, you know how painful that can be.
Really says a ton about the perseverance of these ladies. Getting hurt, coming right back in.
Of course, we saw one of the referees in yesterday's game get a puck in the face, got stitched up, and came right back as Baldwin carries it into the Blades zone, was looking to go on a rush there, but couldn't quite get ahead of the Blades defense. Bellamy at center ice tipped it into the crowd. Watch out as it's out of play with 3:35 remaining in the third.
The only smart one was the little fellow who ran down. He saw that they've got a keepsake puck here from a Clarkson Cup game. Everybody else was standing looking. He raced out of his seat, was quick to it, grabbed it, and was jumping up and down, showing all his friends and family members. Good for him.
He'll have to get a few autographs after the game if he can find some players. Bolden's shot from the center ice area went right on net, and Kessler had to handle it. Koizumi from back behind in the corner. Bellamy pretended to wind up there. Bolden now, and she takes the slap shot. Might have been tipped, but Kessler makes the save. And like a Hoover, like a Dirt Devil, like a, I can't think of another name. If you want to be mentioned, Swiffer's one way to put it. That's a lot of dirt. But if you want to have your vacuum company mentioned on the air, sponsor us next season.
Well, I was just going to say, you said you might want to get an autograph on that puck if you can find someone. That's the great thing about these professional hockey players. These women make themselves available for autographs and to be seen as role models. It's a privilege for them and an honor as well when we hear them talking. They love signing autographs and spending time, especially with young female fans who will hopefully emulate them one day.
Bellamy back to the point. Stack left it for Bellamy. Perfect block by Kohanchuk. And listen to the crowd's reaction. Bellamy then just fired a laser beam. And a chance now. Watch out as Megan Arts gives chase into the Boston zone and then shoves Bolden into the boards, perhaps trying to intimidate her a little bit. I don't think that will work.
I think she was trying to clear a lane for somebody behind her to come get it. If I take Bolden to the boards, the puck's behind both of us. The next attacker in, if it's in a white sweater, has a good chance of getting the puck.
Hillary Knight at center ice, so dangerous. Bonhomme blocks it, and she was a little slow to get up. That might have hit her in a sensitive area as she limps off.
There's an example of blocking shots, and that wasn't even all that hard.
Naslin dumps it into the Toronto zone. 2:10 remaining in the third period. Bonello along the side of the net. The net is knocked off accidentally by Kessler. And a whistle with 2:04 remaining in regulation.
Signs around the arena. They have those things they call the thunder sticks. They're clapping upstairs where there is the beverages for the folks. It's the Molson Canadian Hockey House up there. They're all plastered up against the glass taking this in. They're standing 3, 4, 5 deep, holding their kids behind. Everybody's everywhere watching this and taking it in.
Just got a tweet from Shannon at Seriously Oxford, the Clarkson Cup announcers, making me laugh all afternoon. We didn't make the roster. Great quip. Thank you very much. We try.
Let's try to put it in the correct context. We got another penalty here. Oh, this is incredible.
Wow, both refs with their arm in the air. We'll have to see if it's only one call or perhaps two.
It'll be one, but they both saw it. Therefore, it's egregious. But I'm telling you, in a cup game like this, you got to toss those whistles away. I'm not trying to be critical of the officials. They're doing a great job. I have to see what happened, too. I didn't see the call. But you'd almost have to think a body part would have to roll down the ice in order for a whistle to go to the lips of one of these officials. You'd think that, but in this case, we have another call, and it's gone against Boston.
Digit Murphy paces on the bench for the Boston Blades as Lonis ends up in the box for her. If no goals are on the board, this penalty will extend into an overtime if it's necessary. Brittany Smith at the point. All on the line now for the Furies. Natalie Spooner threw it at the net. Kohanchuk handles it, throws it at the net, and Zamora couldn't get a stick on it. She's so dangerous on her stick handling, getting it from the backhand to the forehand so quickly and effectively. And of course, she's got great foot speed as well. Natalie Spooner has some great foot speed of her own, carries it into the zone, fires it, and it went off the glove of Brittany Otten, dumped towards the line and not out, but Kohanchuk did the Blades a favor there by doing it herself. Accidentally, of course. Last minute of the third period. Brittany Smith along the boards. We need a goal here. Kohanchuk tip behind the net. Christy Zamora getting shoved at by Boston defender. I believe that's Rachel. No, Lonis is in the box. We'll figure that out later.
at the side of the net. Spooner throws it at the net from a weird angle. Prevo behind the net to Kohanchuk. They work the umbrella. Brittany Smith throws it at the net looking for a tip. And it was tipped wide, in fact, by Christy Zamora.
It's Bolden and Taverna out there on the back end right now.
So I believe it was Taverna. Couldn't quite see her number from where we were sitting.
I echo that entirely. I'm always fighting to see the numbers.
I thought her 19 was a 13. Then I realized 13 was not playing. 10 seconds remaining in regulation. Bonhomme tried to pass it to Bolden. Wolfeiler dumps it all the way down the ice. And guess what, folks? Regulation solves nothing. We are going to overtime in the Clarkson Cup Championship game between the Toronto Furies and the Boston Blades. Could you ask for a better outcome or a better game for this one?
No, I don't think so. And it took me a second because I was thinking, well, maybe the call late in the game could be something that's viewed as something that maybe you'd like to see perhaps let go. It was a body contact call against Lannis, who was a healthy scratch last night in the game against the Calgary Inferno. Lannis back in the lineup. Must have been a good body check. I didn't see it initially. We have to apologize. I'm trying to watch all the action all at once. But nonetheless, they're going to head to their dressing rooms after a great 60 minutes of hockey. And we're going to play on some free hockey, if you will, after the 60 minutes is up. They brought the cup out, the Clarkson Cup, with the two RCMP officers. Maybe a little premature, perhaps, of course, because this one is not solved yet and may take a while. There's a 14-second carryover power play opportunity afforded the Toronto Furies as Sammy Joe Small makes her way across the ice. We forgot to mention the two outstanding net miners that aren't in the game. Sammy Joe Small for the Furies, Genevieve Lacasse. Two Olympians sitting on the bench watching this one as well. How'd you like to have that as your, you know, I think if my mainstay isn't doing it for me, look what I've got in my back pocket as an ace in the hole.
And it's funny you mentioned that in our conversation before the game with Blades coach Digit Murphy. She talked about the possibility, and of course this was strictly hypothetical. I don't think there was, obviously there was no prediction on her part, but she was saying, you know, in the off chance that Brittany Ott doesn't have the best of games, she's always got an Olympian in her back pocket. Well, I don't think there's any love lost for Brittany Ott in this game. How about the tournament she's had? 7 of the 9 periods that she's played, she has not allowed a goal.
And it's not just the goaltender, as much as, you know, the goaltenders have been remarkable. And I say this with all due respect, because anybody who's been around the sport knows, not just your netminder. They make that stop. Then the rebound that's swept away, or in the case where Smith, the captain for Toronto, denied Bucer at the side of the net on the power play opportunity to keep it nothing-nothing. It's those around you that help. It's a team sport. As the Beatles once said, I get by with a little help from my friends. The goaltenders echo that sentiment as well.
Huge Beatles fan, and of course that of Mr. Ringo Starr.
We're doing okay. Kate likes it as well on the Twitterverse there. Didn't make the roster. I didn't know we were doing okay.
See, it's always the last thing that you expect people to enjoy gets the most feedback. Well, it's always the throwaway lines on my part. A few days ago, got about 3 or 4 positive responses. What do you think, Anthony? Are you going to be hooked on Twitter from here on out?
I think I might have to be. And that was funny because I was thinking, how do we put it delicately and have a bit of fun with it at the same time. So, yeah, I was hoping it would get a laugh. But some of my best lines of the week went unnoticed by many people. At one point, there was one game where Spooner knocked through everybody and made her way down slice. And I said, it's like a mayor running from the media. And nobody said a word about that. And I'm thinking, didn't anybody see the film that's probably all over the world by now? And it was not. And then finally somebody in the truck told me, oh, no, I caught that. I tweeted it out there. But you got to have a little bit of fun because in reality, this is a very tense game. You go in the dressing room, there's no smiles and chuckles. They don't care what's happening on Twitter. Right now they're focused on the next task at hand, which is solving the opposition's net miner, and that's a huge task. I'm glad I'm not charged with it.
Now, one thing we would like to bring to your attention, folks, we just got a note from actually the CWHL Insider Twitter account, and it was relayed to us by our great director, Steve Mitchell, who's done such a great job from Genmark Productions helping us out here at the Clarkson Cup. If, in case you're wondering, folks, the overtime format for this game will be a 10-minute 4-on-4. And after that, it will go to a shootout. So we'll have to see if these two teams can find the back of the net before we wind up in a skills competition.
Now, I'm just wondering, and indeed, this was the case as we had to go to the extra frame to solve it. In yesterday's game in which Toronto prevailed over the tremendous Montreal Stars in a shootout, they're resurfacing the ice right now, and that's one thing to keep into account. And they're giving the teams a chance to rest. I'm not sure they resurfaced yesterday. I think they went straight to overtime. They did. Did they, Asher? Thank you. They went straight to overtime yesterday, so there was none of this. They took a few minutes to gather their thoughts on the benches. However, now they get to go back inside the dressing rooms and regroup and break things down. Here's what you look out for. Watch this person sneaking in off the point. Keep an eye on this, that, and the other. And then the other thing they do is if it isn't solved in the 10 minutes of overtime, I believe they apply then a dry scrape to the ice, which means no moisture on the ice. They just get rid of any of the slush that's out there, if you will, or the snow that builds up. Get rid of that. And, boy, I hate to see something so important decided by a coin toss, and that's almost what you consider the shootout to be. Those that win the shootout have no problem with it. Those that succumb to the shootout, the worst way to lose possible.
No, I absolutely agree with you there. The, you know, the validity of the shootout in the game of hockey is such a polarizing discussion, really, depending on who you talk to. And really, it's mostly the purists of the game of hockey. But, it, I mean, it goes both ways, Anthony, because nobody likes to see a tie game, at least a tie final.
Yeah.
And, you know, looking at the way that the NHL decided to go into the shootout format and then the rest of the leagues around them and the feeder leagues and the junior leagues kind of followed suit, I mean, they mostly did that, you know, for the fans, for their experience. I have attended a National Hockey League game that ended in a tie back in the day. It really leaves you with a strange feeling. You kind of don't know what to feel. You're not quite happy. You're not angry. You're just kind of like, you're wishing that there's something else there.
That was a regulation game, though, in the regular season, right?
Yeah.
So we're talking about you're deciding a Clarkson Cup.
Oh, absolutely.
Somebody has a chance to hoist the big trophy. It's there on the line. And look at this. Mike Burst weighing in as well. At Mike Burst 21 on Twitter says, a penalty is a penalty. You can't give players a break because it's tied late in the game. Now, I'm going to have to say, and I'm going to go out on the limb, Mike might prove me wrong, but he's got to be a Toronto fan or at least maybe a Canadian fan indeed, because if it's called against you, you say there's no way that should be called, that should be called whatsoever. Penalty's a penalty, yes, but there are things that are let go, and the officials are great at making good non-calls. In other words, I see that you're going 10 over the speed limit, but I'm not going to give you a ticket this time, but they will come up and have a word with you. Look, I saw the little chomping and hacking that you gave over there, or I saw that little, you know, stick in the legs or whatever, and I noticed it, but I'm not going to penalize you for it. Mike makes a great point. A penalty is a penalty, but there's times where the referees and the officials sort of tend to back off a little bit, and I'm sure, Mike, you can appreciate that as well. I do get what you're saying, that a penalty is a penalty. Let the players decide the game. Player is responsible for the penalty. Well, there you go. Mike's weighing in.
And we, of course, appreciate all the feedback that we've gotten on Twitter. And, of course, Mike, don't forget to tweet Anthony as well at...
No. Take all the heat, Asher. I'm fine.
At Little Anthony R on Twitter. Become one of the many prospective followers and catch some of those great quips. Anthony, of course, is a legend in this Toronto broadcasting community. He won't admit it himself, but I'm going to say it anyway. Speaking of legends in the broadcasting community, we're going to head down, I believe, to the media room where Sarah Wright...
We're going to wait for that just a little bit. They're almost finished the scrape. That's why, or the flood, actually, out here. With the two Zambonis, doesn't take as long as it used to do. The Ontario Hockey League, which is part of the Canadian Hockey League, of course, employs a two Zamboni system as well, because they have to have the games tight and on time. And, of course, the CWHL, the professional league as well, two Zambonis here at the Markham Arena. If it was just a typical game, there'd only be one of them out there doing their job. But this one, we're getting ready to go here for the fourth frame of hockey.
Pretty neat there for you folks at home that got to see a nice and up-close look at the Scotiabank Zamboni there. Of course, Scotiabank, the primary sponsor of the Clarkson Cup, and we want to thank them for all the hard work and money that they've put into this tournament. We will talk about our the rest of our main sponsors a little later on. Or maybe we might have some time to do it now. We'll see.
Gidget Murphy talking about what she was going to do. I asked her about adjustments that she could possibly make throughout the game as she was trying a few things out last night with her coaching staff, with Ryan Stone and John Sullivan and Digit Murphy before the game in Calgary. She was over there. They had a dry erase board out, and they were going over a few different things. And I said, are you making adjustments for today's game, which would be the game against Calgary last night, or for tomorrow, which is this game against Toronto? And she said, we're going to try a few things tonight, and if we like the way they work, they may show up in tomorrow's game. But then today she said, no, we're not making any adjustments. We're not doing anything special. Lannis is in the lineup. She said, we're going to have fun. And her quote was,
thanks, gentlemen. I'm here with Jenna Cunningham, one of the assistant captains of the Calgary Inferno. Unfortunately, not in the final today, but you are here to watch, here to maybe cheer on a certain team. Which one are you going for?
Oh, I think it's tough. If we had to side, maybe Toronto today, just because Boston's won it last year, and it's always good to see a new champion. So.
And have you seen, it's been a really tight game, but do you see a little bit of an edge either way?
No, I think it's pretty even. The goaltending tonight has been outstanding. Ott had quite a paddle save there early on, and Kessler's been standing on her head too. So I think it's tight. It's anyone's game at this point.
If you were out there, do you see anything that you could like find a hole, any like game plan you'd have specifically watching this game?
I don't know. I think it's pretty tight. So in a game like this, you're just kind of hoping for that lucky bounce and keep pushing because the teams are just so close that it's almost like you feel like it's almost out of your control. You're just hoping for the right bounce going your way.
And believe it or not, the Calgary team hung out with the Montreal team last night. Everyone in this league is so close. Just quickly tell me how happy you are with the way this tournament went and how close everyone is in the league.
This tournament has been outstanding. Obviously, it's our first year here, and having the opportunity just to get to know the teams outside of the rink and really build that camaraderie among us, I think it just helps when we go out and promote the game and talk about CWHL, is that we really do have incredible women, and we're fun to be around, and it's fun to hang out with the other teams. So we'd enjoyed it. Obviously, we'd prefer to be playing, but it's been good. It's been awesome.
It has been awesome. I totally agree with you. Thanks for taking the time to talk to me. Gentlemen, take it back.
She just threw it out. To the booth as some more interaction. Again, we want to thank everybody and encourage everybody as well to tweet Anthony in addition to myself, at Little Anthony R. Some great debates over the discussion of calling penalties late in the game, and at Craig Drevitt joined into the discussion as well, saying he totally agrees with at MikeBurst21, if you don't want to be down late in the game, don't make an illegal hit. The point is to penalize. So a great point there. And again, folks, we of course encourage you, you know, don't be afraid to disagree with us. Raise your points. Tell us your opinion. It's great to, and in my opinion, Anthony, and you might agree, one of the greatest facets of social media is to have constructive debate and to gain different perspectives from some of the people that you keep in touch with. You know, you can wind up with hundreds of followers on different social media sites, and it's not all about posting selfies and posting statuses about where you are. Sometimes you want to post something controversial, not too controversial, of course, but it's great to hear some of the differing opinions and to feel empowered in that you can state your opinion without being attacked or, you know, it's a great thing, social media, and it should be used for certain purposes.
Only people who, you know, small minds aren't willing to learn and learn something from others. A couple of people weighing in on the subject, and we appreciate their input, and we appreciate they take the time to even weigh in the first place. A lot of people would just sit there and say nothing at all. There's a couple of people saying, you know, yeah, totally agree. If you don't want to be down late in the game, don't make the illegal hit. Great call, and I love it, because, you know, I'm not going to say I am a hockey expert and know every facet of the game and know everything about it. It's just in the hockey world sometimes that's the way it goes. We've seen it in different levels of hockey where the referees seem to be calling very few penalties in the big game, if you will. It's kind of archetypical, if you will, or the way it usually goes. And that's why I was making that statement. Oftentimes, the officials seem to put away the whistles and let little things go, not blatant things, as I said. And I was making the point where a body part may have to roll down. In other words, you'll have to chop somebody down on a breakaway in order to draw a penalty sometimes. I've been around 20 years covering hockey from different levels, all the way up to the Toronto Maple Leafs, down to little Timbit games in my time. So I've had the great pleasure, and I'm never thinking that I know everything, and I'm always willing to learn, and I love the different viewpoints. points, and thank you very much for weighing in.
And this is interesting. At
Kelly.
Kelly at HE11 Oim Kelly says, and she agrees with you, Anthony, late in a championship game, penalties should only be called for inherently dangerous plays. That was a weak call anyway. So there you go. A perfect example. Not everybody has to agree. Make your opinion known. We'll give you the shout out.
They have poutine here. Hashtag, boy, I missed lunch. No, I'm just kidding. I'm just watching somebody walk by with two, count them, two things of poutine here. The snack bar has been tremendous. We have to take a moment while we can, and folks at home enjoying this around the world on SSN, of course, and CWHL website as well. The volunteers have been outstanding here, both in Markham and involved with the CWHL. Many people are free to are freely giving their time in order to further the cause, further the sport, get the word out there, and it's wonderful that they do that. It's for the love of the game. Look at the fans gathered down by where the where they're coming on, both areas where they're coming out of the ice, Boston the opposite side, and over here the Toronto side. Some of the parents are lifting little kids up in the air so they can high-five their role models as they make the... There's a little one there with the FNUF sweater on there. There you go. They can get a glimpse of these athletes. And look at that little girl to the right there with her hand out. That's what it's all about. That could be Geneviève Lacasse down the road. Geneviève Lacasse, pardon me, down the road, waiting to touch. That's what's on the line. That's why I say sometimes it may be harder to draw a penalty in a big game like this, because it can cost you your chance to hoist that beautiful piece of hardware.
And also, Anthony, I'm looking over at where the Boston players were coming out of their dressing room. And again, you talk about things that are so great to see in this game. It was a fan in a Toronto sweater that was there high-fiving the Boston players as they came out. And listen to the crowd's reaction as the Furies re-enter the ice surface in anticipation of this huge overtime period. The most crucial period of play that these ladies will play all year long, possibly with exception to some of the few ladies on either of these rosters that may have been in Sochi. But again, I think that could be argued either way.
Well, obviously, the entire world watching, the whole eyes of the globe were on Sochi and watching. I think 13 million Canadians tuned in to see Canada, U.S. in the women's hockey, the gold medal game there. What a weird and different affair that was at the end of the day. We all know what the outcome was. Of course, we don't need to go down that road yet again. However, it's so wonderful to see the stands filled with fans watching this. There's photographers everywhere. There's media everywhere. Adrian Clarkson, who the cup is named after, is here. We are ready for 4-on-4. 3-on-4.
And yeah, we're underway. It's going to be 4-on-3 for the next 10 seconds before Lannis exits the penalty box for the Boston Blades, and then it will be 4-on-4 hockey for this overtime period. A 10-minute overtime frame, and if that doesn't solve anything, it will go to a shootout. Spooner heads up the ice with some speed. Knight was on her, the two fastest skaters on the ice. Spooner looked for the wraparound chance. Back to the point, Brittany Smith to the side. Prevost, the quick pass intercepted by Bellamy and knocked behind the net. Prevost centering pass to Smith! She scores! Brittany Smith!
Spooner in the air.
Excuse me, it was Natalie Spooner knocking it out of the air. Her goal, and the only goal in this game, is a golden one. And the Toronto Furies, for the first time ever, Clarkson Cup champ.
Sammy Joe Small has said, I have a silver medal from Nagano, two gold medals. I have yet to hoist the cup. The Clarkson Cup, of course. She's doing it now. Now, I apologize for saying Spooner. We'll have to look at this replay as it was a scramble. It was played down low. It went off of, I believe, Ott up in the air. And it looked like Spooner, who was to the side of the net, was swiping at it. Watch 24 in white. And watch carefully here. As look at this nifty little play. Off. There's the pass back to the point. Here comes the shot. Up in the air. Now watch Spooner. She swiped. Oh. No, she missed it. Pardon me.
And what an interesting scenario there as well, because if Natalie Spooner got her stick on that puck, it likely would have been waved off, as her stick was clearly positioned above the crossbar. So almost the Furies would have to be thankful that she did not make any contact with it. So Brittany Smith, how appropriate that the captain of the Toronto Furies winds up with the golden goal in this one.
Here it is again, my friend. Now, take a watch. Now, watch the stick in of Spooner. It's where you'd make contact with it. You're right. That was right about the crossbar. I am glad we're in the booth, not on the ice wearing stripes.
And just looking at the reaction of the Boston players, such a hard-fought tournament for them as we take a look at some of the Toronto players close up. Just jubilance on their faces, and rightfully so.
I talked about eyes as big as saucers, and you said, I wish we could get a close-up. That's what they look like, right there. You got to feel for Digit Murphy, huge proponent of women's hockey. So wonderful, outspoken, forthcoming with the media. And Zamora, Christy Zamora, those were her eyes, I believe we saw earlier. We were. Who got the credit for the goal is the big question.
And contrasting your discussion there of Digit Murphy. And wow, so Spooner does get credit, and we'll have to check to see if that call stands. Because as we said, if Spooner did make contact with her stick above the crossbar, then it might have been a reviewable play. Let's take another look. The initial shot, oh, it was tipped by the stick of Spooner, and that was why it went flying up in the air.
I didn't realize Spooner got a piece of that on the way through.
So there you go, Natalie Spooner, the gold medalist, brings that honor, the highest honor of the CWHL, just 33 seconds into the extra frame after 60 minutes of scoreless hockey here at the Markham Centennial Arena.
The official call in overtime, Natalie Spooner from Brittany Smith, Carolyn Prevost, and there is Adrienne Clarkson to the left. She's just behind the smiling Mountie on the left side of your screen. There's the hardware they're battling for. And our hearts go out to the Boston Blades players. Boy, they were just favored coming in, weren't they? They were gathering momentum. And how about this interesting little tidbit of information, Asher Roth? I was here last year. You were doing the call. I was doing camera helping you out. And it was the Montreal Stars that won three. They railed through the round robin. Won 3-0, but didn't win the Clarkson Cup. Boston prevails in the round robin, 3-0. They didn't win the Clarkson Cup.
And here's an obscure stat to throw at you as well, folks. The Toronto Furies, for the second consecutive year in the Clarkson Cup tournament, their final game played is decided by a goal in overtime. Last year, it was Rebecca Johnson lighting the lamp with 1.8 seconds remaining. Although the biggest difference between that game and this one was that...
Please welcome the Right and Honorable Adrienne Clarkson, accompanied by the Commissioner of the CWHL, Brenda Andress. Accueillons la très honorable Adrienne Clarkson, accompagnée de la Commissaire de la LCHF, Madame Brenda Andress, to present the Clarkson Cup to Brittany Smith, captain of the Toronto Fury. Gentlemen, your 2013-2014 Clarkson Cup champions, the Toronto Furies.
politicians be preachers. Yeah. Be believers, be leaders, be astronauts, be champions, be truth seekers.
Wow.
Just an unbelievable game as the Toronto Furies. The Toronto Furies are handed the Clarkson Cup trophy by its founder, the former Governor General of Canada, Adrian Clarkson.
There's Spooner hoisting it right now, and you and I were sort of smiling to ourselves as we saw the woman who scored the game-winning goal in the shootout yesterday, the only game they got them to this level here, scores the only goal of this game. She's at the back of the pack trying to reach for the cup. This is just incredible. There's Christy Zamora. Give it a kiss, Christy. Hoist it high.
So Natalie Spooner, a point that eluded my mind in the immediate aftermath of the game, Anthony, scored the winning goal in the shootout to bring the Furies to this point. She scored the winning goal in the shootout to bring the Furies to this game, and then she scores the winning goal to bring them to glory.
Glory indeed. They were the second place team behind Montreal, and they were sort of didn't factor in as, or didn't fare as well in that game against Montreal, the Stars, a couple of years ago, in which it was a 5-0 loss. This one, a one-goal game yet again. Again, a one-goal game. And what about the Boston Blades? Digit Murphy is over beside Genevieve Lacasse.
Look at Sammy Joe Small, the former Olympian, one of the league's founders, hoisting the trophy as we see Genevieve Lacasse used her stick to get Commissioner Brenda Andrus's attention. And I can't think of any other situation where you would use that tactic to get essentially your boss's attention, but that really speaks volumes about how neat a person Brenda Andrus is, what a great league commissioner that she is, a great sport. Love to see why Lacasse was trying to get her attention there.
I'm not sure, but they shared a word on the ice. We'll try and look into that. But how about the fact that the Calgary Inferno team are here? They're out on the ice right now as Carey Matamo hoists it high. This is an incredible finish here. And Calgary, including head coach Tim Bothwell and the assistant coaches, the entire organization from Calgary out here on the ice. They're near to the boards. It's hard to see them on the near side here. Because I'm happy, the Pharrell song is being played here, and I'm guessing they're awfully happy right now.
Definitely an appropriate song to be playing in this situation, as Toronto player there, Kristen Marson, who didn't get a ton of playing time throughout the tournament, got to hoist the cup herself there, and now Brittany Smith will carry it back towards the carpet. Let's take another look at that goal, Anthony.
Okay, back of the goal line. Chipped in back of the net. There's Bellamy, who's being a rock on the back end. Remember that odd, the two-on-one rush that was coming down the opposite way? But it gets away from her. It was chipped. Goes back to the open point right side. They're sneaking in off the point and
such
chipped.
Great vision there as well behind the net by Caroline Prévost. And as well, what a job, or what a great move it was for the Toronto Furies, essentially taking Prévost away from the Montreal Stars. I guess she was looking for an increased role, perhaps, on a team, as opposed to playing for Montreal that has so many weapons at forward. Christina Kessler.
Awards for the three stars of the game brought to you by the city of Markham and Cregan Clay. Voici maintenant les trois étoiles du match d'aujourd'hui présentées par la ville de Markham et Cregan Clay. La troisième étoile, the third star from Boston, Brittany Ott. The second star from Toronto, la deuxième étoile de Toronto, Christina Kessler. And the first star from Toronto, la première étoile de Toronto, Brittany Smith.
And we're back here in the booth. I believe we are, if you can hear us. Welcome back. So the three stars of this one, Anthony, I don't think you could have argued that. Ott and Kessler get number three and number two, respectively.
It's funny, we were referencing a game in which Ott stood on her head and made 72 stops, although it was an overtime loss. She stood on her head here again today, and it was one of those miserable goals. It wasn't a clean one. They didn't beat her cleanly. Up and over on a redirect. And as you said, if Spooner made contact, and we saw on a couple of occasions it was a swing and a miss right by the crossbar. If she makes contact with that, well, we had an interesting call down at the ice level, but as it stands, she did not. And Tessa Bonhomme, one of the players I thought may make a huge impact, ends up being one of the stars of the game here as well.
Well, you did call that, Anthony, during the second intermission. Anthony called it by saying that it would be a goal scored on a freak chance. You pretty much called it at the intermission, and lo and behold, it came to fruition.
These are the MVPs of the tournament, of the whole tournament. That's why there's not just the stars of the game here, of course, is Knight. How about Knight walking in all alone there on that, where she stripped the puck at the at her own blue line, walked in and came screaming down the ice on Kessler. I'm telling you, I think Kessler would have rather seen an out-of-control truck coming at her than Knight with a puck on her stick, because Knight is just a hockey-playing machine, is the only way I could put it.
A great tournament for Hillary Knight. She was the tournament's leading scorer.
I think she still is, is she?
Yeah, no, she was the tournament's leading scorer throughout the tournament. Mostly aided by the game that she had last night against the Calgary Inferno, who we should mention are here along the near boards watching the ceremony. And Coach Tim Bothwell, I can see him right in my line of vision, applauding along with everybody else. And Anthony, this might be, I mean, on the one hand, it's great sportsmanship to let his, or to, you know, stay in town and make sure that the players watch this game. But you could also probably say that it's a motivational tactic so that they know what it feels like to both be on the winning end and, of course, in contrast, to be on the losing end, so that they can see the reactions on the Blades players' faces, and probably in addition as well, they get to kind of have a little giggle at the team that tripled them last night.
Well, you know, I wouldn't say a giggle, of course, because they watched this affair unfold as Kessler comes forward and gets honored as well. But that's an excellent point. I didn't think about that, but that's a great point that you're making there, that stay around, watch. This wasn't our year this year, but this is what we're looking for next year. And we're coming back, and we're coming back with a vengeance. We have some unfinished business here, Calgary saying to themselves, and this is what it looks like at the end of it all.
So just before we get too caught up in the analysis and whatnot, I just want to take a quick opportunity to recognize some of the key sponsoring partners for the 2014 Clarkson Cup. Winsport, the Winter Sport Institute, Bauer, Molson Coors, WestJet, Chevrolet, Tim Hortons, of course, the two NHL teams that are affiliated with their respective teams in this tournament, the Toronto Maple Leafs and the Calgary Flames, the Ontario Women's Hockey Association, USA Hockey, Hockey Canada, the IBC, Lois Mitchell, Rocket Sport Dryer, Gong Show Hockey Apparel, Under Armour, Blade Tape, Grote, the first name in Vehicle Safety Systems, and AIA Canada, and of course so many other sponsors, including the Globe and Mail. It's a good thing I mentioned them before. Yep. I didn't even realize that they were one of the sponsors when I mentioned them.
So a good thing there. And here we go. The Toronto Fury celebrate jubilantly on top of the emblem at center ice. Here in Markham, Ontario, the Toronto Furies, as geographically close to winning this one on home ice as any other team, they are the 2014 Clarkson Cup champions, and they win for the first time in the league's six-year history.
And indeed, something else of interest, when Boston went over past everybody and they had to make their way off the ice, I thought, boy, that's going to be a tough pill to swallow after a tremendous outing here at the Clarkson throughout the round robin, etc. And then I looked over, and as they were going off the ice, the fans were all gathered around. And Kazumi, I could see her high-fiving left and right. I saw the blue gloves of Ott going, you know, tapping hands and saying thank yous to the fans. Very appreciative of what the Boston Blades were able to pull off here. To go 3-0 in a tournament at this level is an incredible feat. And to go down by a goal in overtime off a broken play is kind of tough as well, my friend. But, man, somebody has to win at the end of the day, of course. And it's Toronto's turn this time. Boston had their turn last year.
To quickly summarize the champions throughout the league's history, the Montreal Stars, of course, have won half as many times as the tournament has existed. They were the champions in 2009, 2011, and 2012. And, of course, they were the top team in the regular season this year, did not earn a chance to play in the Clarkson Cup final. Other champions over the course of time, in 2010, that was the Brampton Thunder. And, of course, last year, the Boston Blades upset the Montreal Stars in their bid for the trifecta of tournament victories. As the Toronto Furies continue to pose at center ice.
Sammy Jo Small's face there. She's number one, of course, there with the white pads on the left side. When they won yesterday, after the shootout, Sammy Jo with her silver medal from Nagano, and then the two gold medals to follow, was jumping up and down, and we were talking about it, saying she looks like she's 8 years old again, and winning will do that to you, especially this. Said she's had all the accolades and all the awards and, you know, Olympic medals and everything like that, but it's the Clarkson Cup she's yet to capture. Well, we can strike that one off the bucket list, can't we?
And check it out, as the lady, unfortunately, I haven't caught her name, and I spoke to her just before the game. She threw us some compliments about the work we've done. Really thankful for that. And look at her lying on center ice with the Toronto Furies players. She's been wearing a Shannon Molson jersey all tournament long. I'm guessing she probably works for the Furies during the regular season. She's done such a great job with the audio at this tournament, providing the fans with some much-needed musical entertainment.
She's getting a great hug out from Summer West. Boy, Summer said she slept like a baby last night. I wonder how she'll sleep tonight now that it's all over, it's all said and done, and her team prevail. I think she'll really sleep like a baby tonight.
And probably the biggest smile that we've, or the most that we've seen her smile throughout this tournament. It's a tough job being a coach in any sport, really, especially in the game of hockey, where there's so much pressure, so much intensity. Our reporter Sarah Wright is down at ice level trying to get an interview or two, and it looks like she's corralled the scorer of the game winner, Natalie Spooner. She's just going to clarify a couple things before she talks to Sarah. But
oh, they said go ahead first. They were trying to wrangle her for the other caster indeed, but Sarah Wright has got Natalie Spooner in her sights, and she's got her for the interview, the game-winning goal on her stick.
Take it away, Sarah.
Team USA memories when you're out there?
Yeah, definitely. We obviously played against a lot of them in the Olympics, so
try to go 2-0, and we luckily did it today, so it feels great to win both.
Congratulations. Thank you so much. Go join your team. Guys, you can take it back. I'll find you someone else.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Sarah Wright has done such a fantastic job the last couple days helping us out here at SSN Canada. And before she corrals another interview, I just want to quickly take a chance to thank all of the great crew that we have here at SSN Canada and Genmark Productions. Of course, Steve Mitchell and Bank Nethery working the dials for us, making us look and sound great. Of course, Steve's daughter, Jennifer, has been doing a great job working the camera along with Carrie Lonergan. Sarah Wright's done a fantastic job on the reporting. And before she joined us yesterday, Allie Monroe was phenomenal as well. And of course, huge thank you to Anthony Regan for joining us here today on such short notice. And of course, to Nico Cardarelli, the bro behind the mic, who did such a fantastic job on the calls for the first 3 days of this tournament. And I know he's certainly wishing that he could have been here today to cover the biggest game of the year. You just want to thank all of our crew.
You've been doing an excellent job all week long. Everybody following along on Twitter from around the globe, which is quite something, have been singing your praises and echoing your praises. It takes a lot of effort to pull off something like this, and it's been done to perfection here. What a finish this has been. Took overtime to solve it in the 2014 Clarkson Cup. Just an incredible finish, and our hearts go out once again to the Boston Blades, who were just perfection until this last game, and even great in it too, right through regulation. Just took 33 seconds though, and the puck bounces in.
It's funny, Anthony, almost like a crime scene. We can still see the scoreboard says 0-0 and the 9:27 still on that clock. Sarah writes down at ice level with
Thanks,
Brooke Beezer.
Asher. I have Brooke Beezer here. She just told me she hasn't done any media training yet, so take it easy on her. I will too. Brooke, you were in an ambulance yesterday, and now you are lifting the cup. What a turn of events. How are you feeling right now?
I'm sore but excited, so it kind of takes away from all the pain. I got another block shot in the finger, which is painful, but these guys take away all the pain. They are amazing.
And what exactly did you do to your leg yesterday?
I blocked the shot on the inside of my foot, so doctor says it's just a bone bruise. You can play through the pain. So put on the skates, and here we go.
All right, overtime. It looked like we were in for a long run, and you guys got it done right away. Did you know something special like that was going to happen with this team?
I told somebody in the locker room within the 10 seconds of the power play that we had, we're going to score. And all of a sudden, 10 seconds or 30 seconds into this, we scored the goal, and it's awesome.
You did mention the power play. You guys haven't been doing so good, so another turn of events. Tell me about this year, first Clarkson Cup. Tell me about this experience.
This has been the best team I've ever been on, and to be with them through the Clarkson Cup is outstanding. Markham did a great job. Our sponsors did a fabulous job. The gala was great. It's just an unexplainable experience.
And can you see the CWHL just growing and growing with tournaments like this happening every year?
By far. Like, the girls on this ice, there's plenty more to come, and we're going to grow and keep on growing.
Thanks so much for joining me. Have fun tonight. Gentlemen, take it back.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Once again, a great job at ice level and a very candid interview from Brooke Beezer. And it's refreshing for us to hear. She probably thinks that it's not a good thing that, you know, she hasn't received media training. But Nico and I were discussing it yesterday, Anthony. It's so refreshing to get some candid responses, and so many of the ladies in this tournament have been candid with us, and we thank them for that. It's been an absolute treat talking to them throughout.
I was just motioning, gesticulating that we'd like to get Sammy Joe Small, perhaps, with an interview with Sarah Wright, and Sarah's over there right now.
Thanks, guys. I am with Sammy Joe. I've got to talk to her before. She's amazing. It's even cooler now because she has the cup. How does it feel lifting that?
It's pretty sweet. I'm really proud of these girls. I think we put in just an incredible amount of effort this entire year, and nobody expected us to even be in the championship game, let alone winning it. And it's an amazing feeling. I think I fought my whole career to be able to win this, and so to have it in my hands is pretty sweet.
Yeah, your first Clarkson Cup winning team. What is it about this team that makes it so special?
I think the girls just get along really well. Right from the get-go, it was just a group of really nice people, and I think that that just makes a huge difference. People are willing to do that extra effort for that person beside you. Everybody was really willing to play the role, and not always easy roles. We had a lot of girls that didn't dress, didn't play. In that 4-on-4, girls were supporting each other. It didn't really matter. And when Brittany Smith scored, I think half the bench scored. We were just so excited and jubilant and rushing over there. It was incredible. And to see Christina Kessler play the game of her life at the age that she's ever played in is pretty special. And I'm just so proud of her.
How surprised was the team when you found out that Brooke Beezer was going to be good to go?
Well, we know Brooke. She's been hit a lot. She's been hurt a lot. And she's pretty gutsy. So if it's not broken, she's going to play. And so we saw her last night when she got back from the hospital. And she was good to go. She had her foot in an ice bath, but she said she was going to play. So we trust Brooke, and we know that she's going to block shots like she did today. Her finger is the size of a sausage from blocking another shot. She'll probably spend the night at the hospital, but we won the Clarkson Cup, so it's all worth it, I'm sure, for her.
Totally worth it. And you mentioned Kessler. Her game today was amazing all week, really. She got outshot out of all the goalies. How are you more proud of anyone besides her right now?
I mean, I'm incredibly proud of her. Don't get me wrong. I've known that she's been great for years now. So to see her shine on the stage is incredible. But I think I'm most proud of the girls that didn't necessarily get to play as much. And I know what that's like to be in that tough role. And everybody was really supportive of each other. And I think that's what made this team so strong, is that we all wanted to win it for each other. We wanted to win it for the person beside you in the locker room, and for the coaches, for the staff. And everybody just goes that extra effort to really make this league function and to make it great. And I'm handing off the Clarkson Cup to the MVP, and so deserving, because if it wasn't Christina Kessler, it could have been countless other people out there and all the unsung heroes that helped to win that cup today.
And you being a co-founder of the league, looking around all week and especially today, can you imagine what this is going to be like in 10 years?
Well, we have a strategic plan that we're hoping that it will be at a certain point. We're hoping the players will be paid. We're hoping that we have more alignments with NHL clubs. We have a lot of work to do. For me today, it's just about being a player, and it's been a long time since I've just been able to play. And so Brenda Andress and the whole staff has done an amazing job to allow me the opportunity to continue to play and to be able to experience this with this team. It feels so special, because I know that most of these girls have no idea that this league, what it was like even before this. But for me, I've been through all the trials and tribulations, and to see a packed house today, to see it, Adrian Clarkson present the cup was absolutely incredible. So just to all the people, all the volunteers that were out, it's been so special. And I just want to thank everybody that's put in the time and effort into the CWHL to make this really work.
Well, thank you for keeping us entertained. Congratulations again. Have fun with your team the rest of the day.
We certainly will. Thank you so much.
Thank you. All right, gentlemen, that's it for me down on ice level. It's been a great week. I'm going to send it right back to you in the booth.
Thank you, Sarah, and fantastic work throughout the last couple days for you. And I know that I believe you were covering the tournament for another network in the first couple of days, so just a fantastic job by Sarah Wright and a great interview there. We saw that, yeah, she just unintentionally created a scrum there around Sammy Joe Small.
Not a bad idea, though. One of the things that we were noticing there, and Sammy Joe is very graceful, mentioning those that didn't dress, because she knows the role. I mean, she's won medals, obviously. She's been in the trenches. She knows what it's like to be part of the team and maybe not be out there. And indeed, she was watching from the sidelines. You're every bit of the member of the team that everybody else is, including the goal scorer, which we have to say Brittany Smith was credited with the goal. So they changed Natalie Spooner to Brittany Smith. And when Sammy Joe said Brittany Smith scored that goal, I went, ooh, we better check. And we did. We made, because it was credited at first to Spooner, who appeared to redirect. Smith gets the goal. I'm sure you talk to both of them, they'll say, doesn't matter. It went in the net. That's what it is at the end of the day. And then Kessler, to her credit, had the Clarkson Cup, and she saw four little girls and two little boys waiting over by the open bench, and she skated right over with the cup and went to sign autographs and spend some time with them. That's what it's all about, those next generations of players, boys and girls, coming up and eventually maybe playing for the Clarkson Cup themselves, those little girls there waiting to talk to their hero.
It was funny, actually, when we saw Kessler skating over towards that bench, and she seemed to be heading towards Sarah and Sammy Joe over there. I was really hoping for some sort of a video bomb or photo bomb opportunity, but you never know when those things are going to happen. Anyway,
It was a fantastic week of coverage here at the Clarkson Cup. Anthony, what are your thoughts just on everything that we've seen so far?
My second year here at the Clarkson Cup, if I have to come back next year and pay to be at all the games, I will do so gladly and bring family members with me. I've had such a tremendous time. The athletes are available. If you go down and you watch a different game, perhaps with different athletes, Raptors, whomever it's going to be, it's tough to get access to the athletes. When you come to the Clarkson Cup, the players that aren't playing in the game on the ice surface, the other teams, are available to the youngsters around. The autographs that were handed out, they must have, never mind fingers like a sausage from blocking shots, how about signing all the autographs? There are a ton of happy youngsters who hopefully one day will go forward and emulate these tremendous hockey players behind them. So I thought a job well done by the volunteers, the CWHL, the teams themselves. Let's not forget Montreal and Calgary, who are in this every inch of the way, and they had to fall by the wayside. That is the nature of the sport and sport itself. But kudos to them as well for showing up and turning it into a tremendous tournament yet again.
Absolutely. And of course, you know, when we see the volunteers working, it's so easy to forget that they are, in fact, volunteers. Yeah. Most of them so knowledgeable. If we ask them questions, they help us out. You know, we got our media passes. We got some free coffee throughout the week. It was just a great experience for us. And we just want to thank all of you as well for joining us, for interacting with us on Twitter. And I just want to once again go over the crew and thank everybody for helping us out today. For Steve Mitchell, his daughter Jennifer Mitchell, Carrie Lonergan, Nico Cardarelli, who is here for the rest of the week, my partner Anthony Regan, our boss Bank Nethery, and his brother have been helping us in this game. Anthony Regan for helping us today. My name is Asher Roth. Thank you so much for watching us throughout the week, and we'll see you at the next one.